Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resonance Arcade. It is Wednesday night, and we are live.
Hey. Happy New Year again.
Luckily, nobody cares anyway, because Twitch is fucked today, so there's not going to be anybody watching, I think. If we actually do get anybody in the chat channel, it'll be amazing, because it's just not loading at all. But anyway, welcome to those who are watching on YouTube and other places that we host. On this is a gaming podcast for guys from the north of England talk about games for a couple of hours. We've got quite a lot of news this week. We've not been on for a few weeks, and there's been a lot of VR news out there. Today specifically,
today, yeah.
Oculus Rift has been released for pre-order with a pretty hefty price tag. We'll be talking about that a bit later on. Vive, Steam's HTC Vive, has been some of the specs have changed up on that, so we're going to be talking about that a little bit later. And PlayStation VR's also got a little bit of news as well. There's a few other things as well. There's a few other little hardware news things and a few other things happened in the games industry we'll talk about. But as we always do, we shall start off talking about games we've played, and we'll let Lou start.
I've played nothing.
Okay, so this leads us on to the next point, which is Lou has said to us that this is probably going to be his last show with us, because he, for some reason, can't get out of this gaming funk.
No, I can't. I've kind of had my fingers burnt by Fallout 4, among other things, but I'm just...
Don't say that, you'll anger the internet.
I will anger the internet, but I don't care. I just haven't really been playing that many games, as you probably noticed from previous shows that we've been doing, so... It's not really worth me coming on each time and bitching and moaning about things which I've not played. I'll be around as a guest at some point, but this will be my last regular show.
He won't be around as a guest.
Well, if Chris allows me,
he won't. You're dead. You're dead,
dead
to us.
To you.
Absolutely dead. But yeah, I'm because Lou told me this a few days ago, I'm already speaking to a few other people, maybe having a few guests on, and maybe even replacing Lou. We don't know, we'll see, because he's easy to replace. So anyway, so yes, moving on, games that we've played. So Lou hasn't played anything at all. Ste and Sam, have you played anything? It's been Christmas as well, so it's quite a hard time to get some gaming out. It's been very different for me. I've played more games than I've ever played ever. But what about you guys? What about you, Steve?
Well, the only games I've actually really played are the games that me and you played a week or so ago.
Really?
Yeah, I haven't had any chance.
Well, again...
I tell a lie. I played about half an hour of Black Mesa.
Did you get that in the sale, or...?
Yeah.
See, I nearly got that myself. I haven't played it yet, and it's one of those... Is it worth getting right now for me?
I kind of thought it's not completed yet. You know,
shall
wait until... Sorry?
Is this Black Mesa Souls?
Yeah.
It's
free, isn't it?
No.
Yeah, there's a free version of it, but it's now available on Steam to buy as well. It's been kickstarted, I think, too.
Is it finished? Is it the full game now?
No.
There's still quite a few gaps, but I don't know. It was the intrigue more than anything that got me. But like I say, I haven't really had a chance to play it. From the, I basically got to the point where I put the material inside the beam, caused a resonance cascade, and then I'm trying to get up to the surface now.
He said the name of the show.
He did. I've played this when it first came out, when it was free, and I played it right the way to the end of what this is. This basically ends just before Zen, or it did in the version I played. I really enjoyed it.
It's
I
thought pretty far.
It is. It's like Zen was just a pain in the ass for them to do, but I think it's a really nice remake. It's kind of like the Deus Ex remake that I was playing, in that they've changed the layouts and levels quite a bit and added new puzzles and stuff and added enough value-added content to it to make it worth playing again.
But, I mean, Half-Life, even now, apart from the graphics, you know, the models are a little bit blocky and the textures are a little bit low-res, it's still a good game to play. It feels good still to play, and it's interesting story. And if you haven't played it for a while, it's good to go back to it and kind of, you know, you're a bit fresh, aren't you? You forget things about it.
Yeah.
Towards the end of the game, when the combines start kicking off, I'm a bit sketchy. You know, I know it, but I'm a bit sketchy, so... So yeah, are you going to continue with that then, or are you?
I'm intending to. It is quite well. It's very similar, but very different in some respects as well. Like now, I'm trying to get up the surface. The only weapon I've got available to me are flares that I can find lying around on the ground. So you just pick up a flare and you got to throw it at, you know.
There is crowbar, isn't there?
I'm going to say there's a crowbar and you do
we don't get that yet.
You get the crowbar.
You get that when you go to the first door, I'm sure.
Yeah, you do.
Well, they've changed that then.
All right. Well, they've changed it since I played it as well then.
Oh, you missed it and it's gone forever.
You can't get through the first door without a crowbar.
You can't get through the door without it. But what you can do now is you can throw parts of the scenery. So there's a chair or like a cup or something, you can throw that and you can break glass with them.
Okay.
So you can get through it that way.
Oh, we've got a viewer that hasn't been around for a while in chat. TSAG actually did an interview with us a while back. He says, last night on Twitch, the game's done quick, guys. We're doing a speedrun of Half-Life 2 and it really made him fully appreciate the movement of the game. It's not quite Black Mesa, but yeah, the whole Source engine and what was the original Half-Life engine called?
Gold Source, it was called.
All right, okay, so
it was Quake 1 derivative, yeah.
Yeah, but it's just Quake, isn't it? I mean, we're old school Quake and Quake 2 players, so we do appreciate the mechanics and the physics.
The physics and the mechanics in Half-Life 2 in Source are particularly crazy. I think I showed you a video of the accelerated back hopping that they do.
Yeah,
they basically do the whole level in reverse. Because what they did, Valve made it so that you couldn't bunny hop forward, but they didn't do anything about bunny hopping backwards. In fact, the maths they used to do it make it work better in reverse.
Yeah, yeah. Just as a no.
Because it adds a negative velocity to you when you try and do it. So if you're going backwards, you get that added to your speed.
Yeah. Brilliant. They've probably fixed that, though, I imagine, since...
No, they haven't.
Actually, no, why? I mean, what's wrong with bunny hopping? Unless it breaks the single-player game element, I don't see what the problem is.
I think it's more for the multiplayer stuff.
Right. So if everyone can bunny hop, though, again, that's the beauty of it. We talked about this before. Learning how to do that kind of thing is what makes the multiplayer aspect fun, instead of everybody... No, let's not get into modern shooters.
I completely agree with you, Chris.
But aside from Black Mesa, we played a couple of hours of Ark.
Yes, we did. And what do you think? What? Because we didn't really talk about it after we did it.
No. I enjoyed it. It was a bit frustrating at times, but here it is.
Yeah, well, you know when we played Savage Lands, Lou?
Yeah.
It's basically the same game with a little bit better fidelity and dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs?
Is that dinosaur running around in the snow?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's basically you have to...
an animal in the snow.
They love it. They love frolicking in the snow.
You start off on an island, you're running around collecting rocks, you punch trees, but when you punch trees, you actually hurt yourself. Oh, you've got a little map as well, which doesn't make any fucking sense or help you whatsoever. But
hold the map.
Yeah, it's really, really elaborate as well. There's a really complicated upgrade system in it, but we only kind of scratched the surface of what you can do with it.
I'd like to give that a try.
We did. We were kind of trying to get you involved in it, but you weren't available at the time. It is good. I mean, it was in the... I think I sent you a text about it, in fact, to say Ark is on sale. Go and get it. I think I sent you one. That's why Steve went and got it. That's probably honestly, just if I get a chance to look at, if you look at Steve again, he looks absolutely ridiculous. I posted a picture on Twitter.
Yeah, I did see the picture, yeah.
I just clicked OK on my character, so I just look normal like that.
Is that normal, Chris?
Well, that's normal for me, you know, obviously that's what I look like underneath. But no, it's got some really good merit.
Saw him.
It's got some really good merits, but it's also got some really frustrating kind of like placement mechanics. It's really hard to place walls and ceilings at times, and it's not fully clear how things work. You can build a shack and then a T-Rex, which there was a fucking T-Rex that was just running around destroying us and eating our faces off every 5 seconds. They can just walk through them. We didn't actually experience it destroying our base, but they apparently can just destroy everything because everything's got a durability on it.
You have to keep eating as well.
Yeah.
And you're randomly shit. As in, like, you're just shit.
Yeah, you randomly defecate all over the place. But you can pick that up and use it as fertilizer for farms, which we didn't get to again, but I've been doing a little bit of reading. You know those big lines that we saw in the distance? They're beacons, and that's where a chest is. But they're quite... If we'd actually got there, we'd have probably died instantly because they're surrounded by like really high level beasts. apparently.
Can you throw your poo at a Tyrannosaurus Rex when you try and get it in its eye or something?
I don't know about that, but you can tame Tyrannosaurus Rexes, and you can also, well, it's hard apparently, but you can tame everything, and you can have farms and all kinds of shit running. It looks really in depth and complicated. There's a dedicated server version as well, and you can tweak a lot of things. So you can tweak the first time we played it, our hunger was going down very, very, very quickly, and it was like, this isn't really that fun. So I had a look at the options on the standalone server. I wasn't running the dedicated, I was running my own version of it. What's it called? Client?
Listen.
Yeah, listen server. And you can up things like the amount of stone you get when you're harvesting, and the hunger rate and that kind of thing. You can change it all and tweak it quite well. You can make it like you can make yourselves invincible if you wanted to. But there was also a point where we were trying to get Ste. I was trying to get Ste in my clan. Was it a clan? Is that what they call it?
It was something akin to a clan, a tribe or a
tribe.
Clan.
That was it. Yeah. I kept inviting him, but he just didn't notice or didn't get the invite. And then he invited me to his clan, so I joined his clan. And then all the stuff that we'd built was for my clan, so we couldn't even open or close a door on the shack that we'd spent fucking ages building. So it's like, and then there's loads of console commands as an admin you can use, but I couldn't be bothered with it. But yeah, it's good. It's worth a shot, I think.
Yeah, it was enjoyable to play, and it's definitely got potential.
Yeah, and they're still working on it as well. You see dev updates quite a lot.
Well, I noticed there was a 2 gig download for it the other day, and I've just turned Steam on now, and there's a 1.8 gig download for it.
Yeah, I think it updated a few days ago for me. But yeah, they're releasing new patches every day, so get it, Lou, if you want to play it.
Yeah, I might do.
Because we were looking at it a while back, weren't we?
We were, yeah. I mean, I've recently seen a lot more people playing it, like people who I wouldn't expect to be playing these kind of games. And it looks like it could be fun. I still want to try DayZ. But I don't know how far they've got along with that.
I've played a bit of DayZ, not the new one, but the Arma 2 one. And I mean, I've watched a lot of Twitch DayZ, and it's just full of arseholes. It's just full of people that are basically like a human would be in the zombie apocalypse, going around ganking everybody for food and items and weapons that they're carrying, and being really dishonest with each other as well. It's like, come on, follow me over here and we'll do this. And it's like, watch out, he's going to gank you. As soon as he gets you around the corner and your mate's not around, he's going to kill you.
That's kind of adds a bit of charm to it though, doesn't it?
I can't be arsed with that. Other people, I think, unless it's like cooperative with a mate, I don't think I can be asked.
We played a bit of was it Dungeon Siege 3?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a bit crap.
Dungeon shit. Dungeon shit 3. Yeah.
There was the entire Dungeon Siege pack on Steam on sale for like a couple of quid.
I don't think they've ever cracked the original of that, have they?
Well, 2 I thought was brilliant. I loved 2. I think I've played 1, but I don't remember it. But I have played 2 to death, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. But this one just feels a lot more like a hack and slash to me, you know?
Is Dungeon Siege 3 the one that was released quite recently? Because Dungeon Siege, the first one, is really old now, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really old.
I think it's Diablo 3.
It's recent-ish. I don't know exactly when it came out, but it is recent-ish. It feels like... And also, we had problems with controls, didn't we?
Yeah.
And the camera, and we couldn't... We have to stay on the same screen together, so it felt more like an arcade game than it did the original Dungeon Siege, which is doesn't. When you move away from each other in Dungeon Siege 2, you can do it. It's not suggested because you wanna try and stay together as much as possible so you can kill the enemies. But this game, you can't leave the same screen. It's single screen play, and it's
weird.
And we were playing multi, you know, over the net.
Yeah, on your own screens.
That seems oddly restrictive.
Seems like Gauntlet. Maybe it's Gauntlet-esque, isn't it?
They just kind of completely smacked of this was made for console.
Well, this was made for consoles on the set. Yeah, like,
well,
with two
even
people.
Even I was gonna say, even consoles are all net connected, so you still wouldn't need to share one screen, even if you were playing on consoles.
Specifically, the interface and the. The control system actually played better on a pad than it did on mouse and keyboard, which is yeah, it's not. I mean, Dungeon Siege 2, there was that many bloody buttons and shortcut keys and hotkeys and stuff. It was like, it felt like an RPG, whereas this felt like a really dumbed down version of one. It looks nice, don't get me wrong. Well, that doesn't look nice.
You say that, and then he turns it.
Okay, from the top down, kind of isometric view, it looked okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But yeah, no, not particularly my cup of tea.
Mm. Aside from those, nothing, unfortunately.
Nothing at all.
I'm just looking through my Steam library now, and I bought a couple of games, but I haven't had a chance to play them yet.
I tend to find if I forget what I've played, I'll just look at my recent played list on recently played on Steam, and that'll remind me unless I've not played a Steam game. Well, Sam?
I haven't really played that much. I did have my mum, her fella, and his granddaughter, who, for lack of a better term, is kind of like my step-niece, were down for a few days over New Year. And just to keep her entertained for a bit, she asked if she could play on some games, and I was like, well, she's 7 years old, and most of my games are a 15 or an 18. Yeah, God of War, The Last of Us, you know, Dark Souls. I was like, well, I don't have that many games. So I was like, you can try out a bit of Ratchet and Clank, which is a bit more kiddie. And she'd never played on a console before, and it was quite weird to think that I started out playing like Sonic the Hedgehog, which she had to go at as well, because I've got like a Mega Drive collection.
Oh, right,
disc. But it was interesting to see somebody who's never done it before and go, right, these are the buttons on the PlayStation controller. This, you can't do this, this. And like, we're just watching somebody, like a child completely new to it, picking it up. It was kind of like weird and kind of like interesting to watch.
Was she good?
She wasn't good, but she was, after like about half an hour of playing Ratchet and Clank, which has got quite a complicated control scheme compared to like Mario. Like, you've got aim, you've got jump, you strafe, you've got gadgets, you've got weapons, you've got all this kind of shit. And she was sort of starting to get the hang of it. She kept walking off the edge of stuff and dying. I was like, well, you keep walking off the end, then you're gonna die. And then she had to go on Sonic and kept jumping into spikes, but she got a handle on that one a bit more quickly. So I was just playing, you know, like on I think Sonic 3 you can play as Tails.
Yeah.
With the one with the Sonic, so you're basically just an invincible idiot who jumps around and gets in the way. I was doing that and trying to like help her out a little bit, but she kept just fucking off and jumping into water. And, you know, like kids do, but I wasn't. Other people that were sat around were like, go up here, you should do this, that, and the other. And I was like, just let her figure it out. Let her fuck up and get it wrong and find her own way to do it. You're not going to be good at a game by having 50 different people telling you where to go and what to do all the time.
Especially not as a beginner. Now, I mean, my wife's not a big gamer. I mean, she plays her old Amiga games, but she doesn't play modern games. Over Christmas, we've had a few goes, and every time something complicated happens, she just hands the controller to me. And she, or there was one moment we were playing Zombie U on the Wii U, and there's a button that does a 180. It's right next to the aim button. so I said, press the left trigger button, and she was pressing the left, whatever the top button's called. They've got weird names. ZR and Z. What are the Steve? You've got a Wii, haven't you?
Wii ones. I'll just call them the bumper buttons.
There's two bumpers, the, and then there's the triggers underneath. Yeah, it's the bumpers, yeah. So yeah, she just kept pressing this 180 button, and she's just doing, just spinning on the spot, and I'm like, you're gonna die.
You're
funny.
Gonna die, but you're gonna twirl while you do it.
Yeah, you're gonna look fabulous.
But it just made me think a little bit about how I started out playing like Sonic the Hedgehog and really simple games, and how if you to try and like give somebody who's never done it before and say, right, here's World of Warcraft, get on with it, you're like, what the like, it's so complicated. Games are so, how much more advanced and complicated they've become, that for a beginner, a kid, is different, because you can like, kids learn really quickly anyway. But if you to say, get someone who's like our age who never played games before and sit them down with Final Fantasy VII, even, that's a kind of old game by now, but any game like that that's got really complex systems and things, they wouldn't know what the fuck to do. Like, it'd be so weird and alien to them. It just made me think a little bit about that, and how for some people, it's just not something, they're too far behind almost to start now. Do you know what I mean? Like, because they'd have to have tutorials literally in how to play games to get a basic understanding. Like we can get a game, and you get, if it's on a keyboard or a controller, you know basically what the buttons are going to do. You know that spacebar is going to do whatever spacebar normally does on PC games. I know that X is usually jump on a controller. Square is usually attack. Simple things like that, like you just common things that you're so used to. You take for granted that how you think how easy it is and how you can just jump into a game and play.
Or if you say to somebody, press X.
And they're like...
Now, one, all three of the major consoles, the X is in a different position.
Yeah.
Because the X on the Xbox is on the left, the X on the PlayStation's at the bottom, and the X on the, what's it called?
Wii. Does the Wii have one?
Yeah, it's X, Y, and it's A, B.
Do you know, I never got used to that. Whenever a game tells me to press a button, I've got to look and see what button it is and match the colour. And it's like, I never used that.
It's Sony that moved away from convention then, because it started off with the Super Nintendo that had X, Y, A, B. Microsoft adopted the same system. Nintendo have obviously carried it on, but Sony have changed to the shapes.
Yeah.
They changed the position of the X button.
That's why the Final Fantasy games had the main button as circle, because we used to be where X was on the SNES pad.
They're also trying to avoid copyright infringements and all kinds of stuff, aren't they? So the more they can deviate from it, the better. But that also causes us gamers problem who aren't particularly like, oh, I'm just a PlayStation guy, you know? We've got them all. It's a bit annoying.
Yeah.
Anything else then, Sam?
No, I didn't really play anything else. I was more of a spectator.
Yeah.
So, no, that's it.
Whereas it looks like Chris has actually played all the games.
I'm pretty sure this list is everything on Steam, isn't it?
It's almost everything. However, there's a guy I have on Steam who's got 3,300 games.
Is that Spiv by any chance?
No, it's a guy called Lashman, who's an indie dev kind of 3D guy. But yeah, he's playing it constantly. He's always playing on Steam, but he's got every game. I'm trying to catch up with him. I'm on 350, I think, now or something. So out of my list, is there anything that any of you guys want me to talk about or you're interested in my opinion on?
Whoa. You go first.
Go on, Steve.
I was just going to ask before we start talking about games, what your opinion of the Wii U was.
Okay, that's I could talk about the Wii U games I played then in that case. I love it. I really do love it. And I didn't think I would. Sal got it for me and it was a complete surprise. And I was really, really chuffed with it. It's like, it was my main present when I opened it. And I was like, I got this big heavy box and I'm like, what's it going to be? I didn't even think it might be shoes. It could be anything. Anyway, opened it up and I was like, oh my God. I didn't ever think that I'd genuinely be surprised about a Christmas present these days.
Yeah.
But anyway, I got it and I was like, and I thought, oh, there's not, and as soon as the first thing I thought was, there's not many games on it. So as soon as I opened it, I went, that's why I haven't bought one yet, because there aren't many games that I want to play. However, Zelda's coming up, so I would have got it this year or next year anyway, unless it's coming out on the next Nintendo console, which they're saying they might do, so.
That's what I'm not sure about with it, yeah.
However, I've got new Super Mario Brothers U.
Is that the 2D one?
Yes.
And
there's also Luigi U with that as well, which is basically the same game, but all the levels have been changed. So it's the same world, but all the levels have been made a lot harder. Plus Luigi jumps higher and runs faster and slides more. Anyway, I've completed over Christmas. I completed the new Super Mario Brothers Wii U. I haven't got all of the star coins in it, but all of them in the first couple of worlds now, but I'm going through those. But yeah, I completed it and I really like the graphics on it. It looks really nice for a Nintendo
console.
It's
really crisp, isn't it?
Yeah, and even though it's still low kind of realism.
Yeah.
It's capable of better graphics than I've seen two games now. I played a few demos as well. I downloaded a few demos. So I downloaded... actually, let's continue with the Wii stuff first. So the actual control pad, I love the fact that most games that use it quite well from my experience so far. But I also love the fact that I can go downstairs in the front room and while she's watching EastEnders, I can just turn on the console and I can play a few Star Coins in Mario on yeah. that, like it's a handheld, and that has a lot of value for me because I don't want to be taking it out. I won't play it if I have to move it into the other room and then play it a bit. I won't play it at the moment. So it's really good, and the screen's really crisp. It's dead responsive. It doesn't feel like you're streaming it, which is what it's doing. It's streaming it directly from the console, and it feels really nice. And I like the pad.
It feels nice.
Yes, yeah. Touch screen as well. Yeah. You don't have to touch the screen though. It's got two analog sticks and a D-pad and eight buttons.
Well, I was going to ask because I'm sure you probably get onto it, but I remember seeing when Zombie U came out, one of the features that I thought was quite cool is that you have to use the gamepad screen as your inventory management, but it's in real time. So you can't pause the game, but you can move things around in your backpack, as it were. But you do that on there rather than going to a separate menu. Yeah. I thought that was quite cool, a little innovative little thing.
As I said, each game uses it differently. It's not going to, you know, I mean, each game I played, like Super Mario, you can just play Super Mario on it. That's all it is. There's no additional options apart from if I'm playing the game with a Wii pad, which is another thing, by the way, the backward compatibility, it works with all my Wii peripherals, and all my Wii games work in it as well. Just I don't need to convert them or anything. It just goes into a Wii emulation mode.
Virtual console, isn't it?
Yeah, and you put the Wii disc in, and you're playing a Wii game, and it's upscaled as well slightly, so it looks quite good. I know it was 480p, wasn't it, the Wii or something like that? It was a low res anyway. So I've been playing a few old Wii games because of that, and it's got a few Wii games that I didn't actually play on the Wii because I set it down and then I didn't bother resetting it back up. Anyway, so yeah, Zombie U, I really enjoyed that as well. I got it because we saw it in cash converters for like £6, and I thought, oh, bugger that, we'll grab that, why not? Yeah. Sal's a massive Zombie fan, which anybody who watches the show will know already. And I played the demo first. We downloaded the demo along with a few others, and got the game. And it's really quite scary. Have you played it, Steve?
I played the demo. I know you mean it's one of those you're just waiting for something to happen. You know it's coming, but it builds the suspense really, really well. Then there's noises everywhere. That's one way you've got you scan the area, don't you, and you find out where there's key items, and you've got to go through and try and navigate your way through the furniture or the building in order to find them.
Yeah, so there's a few different uses for the Wii Pad, which Sam touched on there. So the first one is, while you're just normally walking around, you can manage your inventory, but it's not real-time necessarily. Your character stops on the screen. Your character kneels down and goes into the backpack whenever you're trying to loot something. But if you're managing your inventory, you can... So if you've... So when you open your backpack, you drag down from the top of the screen, and then the character on the screen kneels down, gets into the backpack, and then you can manage it, but the zombies are still moving around you, so you have to be in a safe place for it to happen. But you can do standard things in zombie games, like barricade doors and set fire to them with molotovs and upgrade your weapons. There's a central area, but it also, I think it's like a procedural game as well, because every time you enter a new area, the zombies are either, they're not always in the same place, they're always in slightly different places. Sometimes if you go back to your base, there's a siege occurring. You can go back to old areas as well and go and get items that you've dropped. And if your character dies, and I think this is a brilliant feature, but it's a feature that apparently was in a 1980s game, which I can't remember the name. I think it might have been called Zombie, actually. If your character dies, you have to go and find your character and get all of their backpack items back off them because they're now a zombie, which is quite a cool feature. Yeah,
that's cool.
I heard about that and I thought that's a really cool thing to do in a zombie game. It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Now the only problem with that is that I didn't realise that it only applies to the last character that dies. So I had loads of stuff with one character, got killed after maybe, I think I've been playing for about half an hour, 45 minutes. You get more points the more you collected and the better you are. Got killed, and then there was, because there was a siege on at my base, and then I went back out of my base to where the siege was occurring and tried to run to my character to get it, and then another zombie came down from behind, jumped down the ceiling, grabbed my character and ate my other character. So then when I went back out, only the last character was there, so I lost all of the items on the first one. I was like, oh god, if I'd have known that, I'd have been a bit more careful, you know. But anyway, you live and learn, don't you? But again, you can, it's procedural, so you can go back to areas and get old, you know, get items back and stock up, etc.
So is it like a narrative driven game, or is it more of an exploration?
There's a narrative in it. So yeah, initially you start off on you wake every time you get a new character, they wake up in like a type thing in the middle of in the middle of your headquarters. It's narrated by a guy who's actually in Coronation Street at the moment. It's narrated by an actor. He's apparently a fairly well-known actor. I've never seen him before, but he's in. Anyway, he's
Kevin
in
Webster.
No.
Sally, the zombie's coming.
I think he's actually Carla's dad or something like that in Cory. Anyway, I know none of you guys watch Cory, so. Anyway, so he narrates it, and he's basically saying, I've had loads of guys before, loads of people before you, and none of them have listened to me, and you better listen. Anyway, you know, he kind of directs you to different areas. I don't know if there's an end to it, though, because it looks like on the leaderboards on the game, when you die, you get a list of all of the people that have done the best today and all of the people that have done the best overall. And it's like, what, do I just scavenge forever? Is that the point? Do I just go out and collect stuff and go to different areas? I've just ended up, I'm in the sewers under Buckingham Palace at the moment, which is like the third or fourth level. But I don't know if after I've opened all of the levels, it's just open-ended, you know, and you can
there
just keep...
There better be a zombie Queen Elizabeth.
I did say that to Sal.
Or a zombie Prince Charles. Zombie Prince Philip.
Yeah.
It's the case for his
he'd probably be more well-mannered than the real Prince Philip.
Well, yeah, there's another use for the gamepad as well in the game. We played some of the multiplayer, and in the multiplayer, you can play, again, with the Wii pads or the Wii Pro controller or whatever. And in fact, it's a first-person game, so you can use the nunchuck as well and do the aiming thing, you know. I don't know if you've played any first-person games on the Wii. It's not good. It's not nice. You move with the nunchuck, and then you use the Wiimote to move your screen around. So you kind of... It doesn't feel natural to someone who plays an FPS, but I imagine to someone who doesn't play FPSs and plays a Wii, it's actually quite natural, if you know what I mean. It's hard to describe. Anyway, one of you plays as a survivor, and the other person plays as the king of the zombies or something, and it's just another guy who basically puts zombies in an arena. So there's a few different ones. There's one where you just have to see how long you can survive, and there's another one where it's a king of the hill type thing, and you have to go and, or capture and hold, and you have to go and capture an area, hold it, get a point, move to another area, hold it. But the other person who's on the gamepad just basically selects zombie types. So there's lots of different, you know, exploding zombies, zombies that are on fire, and king zombies or whatever, and puts them around the map, and they have to strategically place them, so as you're playing the game, they'll just appear and try and kill you. So it's quite interesting.
Sounds a bit like Crawl, that.
Maybe.
Similarly, you've seen Crawl, haven't you, where everyone else plays as the enemies.
But they play as them, don't they?
Yeah, they do.
This isn't the same, so the zombies are autonomous, but they place them on the map.
Right.
So that's really good for me and Sal, because Sal can't play games, but she can tap a screen and place zombies around me. So I can survive for ages trying to kill, you know, killing the zombies, but she can't die. She can just fail, if you know what I mean, she can't die, because the whole point is you see how long you can survive. They get more and more and more zombies and more resources as time goes on. It just ends up with hundreds of zombies around you, and you're just running out of ammo every 5 seconds and complaining that the Wii controller's rubbish to play FPSs with. That said, Super Mario U, I played a bit of Paper Mario, which is a Wii game, which is a game that you flip between 2D and 3D planes in, but it's like an RPG, and it doesn't have Bowser in it, and it's a very weird kind of Mario game. It's
there's been quite a few Mario games, haven't there, where they've done this a few times, Nintendo, where they've had an idea for a game, and they've gone, ah, we're not sure if we're that confident with that. We'll make it a Mario game. So we'll slap that. I think that was one of those games where they had like a mechanic and a game system, and they were like, oh, let's make it a Mario game. I've heard that it's very different from most Mario games.
It is very different in that you start off, and yeah, fair enough, Princess Peach gets captured, but she gets captured by this guy called Count Black. And all he does, right, is go black, 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 black as a laugh all the time. And everything is black this and black that. And it's like, fucking stop saying black for fuck's sake.
Like the Smurfs.
Yeah, yeah, kind of thing.
Smurf you and Smurf everybody.
But it's also, it must have been written by someone different because it's very tongue-in-cheek and very, like, takes the piss out of itself. But it's one big world. And you're just running around on this 2D plane, and you return back to old areas you've been to, and there's a few different things. Because it's a Wii game as well, you've got this bloody, you know, like Navi in Zelda. It's that kind of annoying kind of, well, they're called pixels in this, P-I-X-L, and that you collect them. I've only got like two at the moment, but there's one that when you get this pixel, you can pick blocks up and throw them. Another one is you can aim at the screen with a Wii remote and see secrets on the screen and stuff. And I haven't played it too much. I've only really played it to the same point I played it last time I played it. So I'm maybe a few hours into it. But I think I will try and continue with it and see how far it goes. But yeah, there's a few enemies and they've all got their own little kind of tongue-in-cheek catchphrases, and It is very Nintendo, but it's also quite different from them. And the main mechanic is that you press a button and you basically flip from 2D to 3D. That's it. But when you're in the 3D world, you can only move in 2D planes anyway, forward and back, left and right. So it's really quite jarring, especially if there's a cube over to the angle. You have to still move right and then forward. It's a bit weird, but it's different. What else have I played? What else have I played?
Everything.
Oh, played the Marvel Lego Heroes demo on the Wii U as well. Didn't rate it much, I'll be honest. I mean, some of the Lego games have been alright, bit of fun, but it's just...
all kind of the same, aren't they?
Well, you can play every bloody Marvel hero ever, and it's like... every single one's got slightly different controls with all three of the buttons that you use, and it's like you have to use Iron Man to, like, take silver objects in the world out, and then use the Hulk to pick up, like, to pull green levers and it's like, just,
it's tenuous as hell, isn't it? It's just like we've got the rights to all these characters now, let's just stick them in a game with the same mechanics. I presumably it's a top-down platformy sort of game where you collect shiny Lego bits.
Is that right?
I don't know.
Sorry.
Years and years ago, and it looked like that.
I was reading chat. I played some of the Lego Star Wars games, and I think I might have played a demo of the Batman game. And yeah, you just have little Lego bits you collect while you're running around. Anyway, thanks to whoever just subscribed. I got a bit distracted then. I wasn't paying that much attention, but I assume it was Trailer Sofa who's in chat. So thank you very much.
Come on, you've got a lot to get through here.
That's it with my Wii games, but I also went a bit crazy on the Steam Winter Sale, so I've got tons. I'm going to go through the ones that I've bought that I haven't played. I haven't played them, so I can't say much about them, but these are the ones I'll probably be talking about next week or the next time we get together. A Druid's Duel, which I've had on my want list for a while. It's a strategy turn-based game where you just place druids around and they all do different things. I haven't played that much of it, but it looks right up my street, and it was a couple of quid, I think. So I got that. Endless Legend, which I know you've got, Steve. Have you played it, and do you enjoy it?
I've played it. Not a lot, though. Not enough, I'd say, to give it a truthful review.
It looks quite complex.
I found it quite... it's not as easy to get into as I thought it was going to be, so it's going to take a bit of time, and I haven't really got around to dedicating the time to getting to know how the mechanics work and what have you.
I think I got the DLC pack as well with everything, all the DLC on it. It was only a couple of quid. I think it was a tenner for all the DLC, but it might have been 2 quid for the game.
Yeah.
I don't know if the sale's still on, but it was yeah, anyway, I'll play that at some point, but I don't know when, because I think, as you just said, I'd need a bit of time to get into it. Game called The Escapists, which is I think it's just a single player indie game about escaping from jail. I think it's just a narrative single player game. Again, I've had my eye on it for a while, been looking forward to playing it. Her Story, which is, I quite like explorative games, you know, like Gone Home and The Vanishing of Ethan Carter and that kind of thing. And this looks like it's a game where you go through video archives, police video archives, and you're trying to figure out what the story.
I've heard about this.
Yeah, and it's
I've heard about it.
It again, different, and it was cheap, and I thought, I've had that on my wish list for a while, why not get it while it's 60% off or whatever, you know?
Is it something to do with the murder and you try to find if she did it or not, or something like that?
Something like that. I haven't played it yet, so I can't really say much about it. Mad Max, haven't played it yet, but as Steve's recommended it, and it looks right up my street. Satellite Rain, I know Steve's got this as well. Have you played much of that?
About 20 minutes.
What did you think of it?
So far, I was expecting Syndicate. It's not Syndicate.
Oh. It's probably been touted and hyped itself up as the next Syndicate Wars, hasn't it?
I bet it's more complicated than your 20 minutes gives it credit for, though.
Yeah, it's... Each character, you get different skills. So you get hackers, you get security experts, and you've got to send people over a hacker door where you can open there. So it's almost like a bit of a puzzle game crossed in with it as well, which I kind of wasn't expecting.
It sounds to me like...
Shoot shit, don't you? You just want to get a million people in the car with their rifles.
Yeah, I was expecting kind of like shooting and strategy, but I've got kind of stealth and puzzle instead.
That sounds like I'd enjoy it, though. It sounds...
Yeah, I mean, which isn't a bad thing. Like I say, that's why I haven't spent as much time playing it, because it wasn't, when I started playing it, it wasn't what I expected.
So I've also got, that really reminds me of this next game, Shadowrun Hong Kong, which is a new Shadowrun game. You know, the Shadowrun Returns, and they did a deluxe version of it, and there was another one, Dragonfall. Was it Dragonfall?
Something like that. Someone I got.
Yeah, so I've played the other two, and I loved them, and this one's just a new one, so I'll hopefully love this as well. This War of Mine, had my eyes on it for ages. I nearly played it today. Yeah, it's one of those that I just think I might need a bit of time to play. Transistor, again, it's the follow-up to Bastion, which is one of our friends is playing at the moment, Ozzy. He's playing Bastion right now. He keeps popping up on Steam. And Bastion was that isometric single-player game where you have
very
to just...
pretty game.
Yeah, it looks pretty, but I have to be honest, I completed it because I wanted to get to the end, but I got a bit bored of the mechanics and the same kind of... It's just a hack and slash, you know, you upgrade your weapons as you go along and get slightly better weapons, and it didn't do much for me. But again, Transistor's apparently supposed to be slightly different, but we'll see. And Dungeon Siege 1 and 2 with the Dungeon Siege pack. So they're the ones I haven't played. The ones that I have played... Right. So Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain, I finished it, I completed it at last. And I really want to talk to Sam about it, so hurry up and finish it, Sam.
All right. Well, you want to do a full spoiler discussion?
I want to do a full spoiler discussion, and we're going to have someone stood in the corner with their finger up for the entire duration, because there's a lot to talk about.
I'll get it finished.
There's a lot of conjecture, at least, and a lot of, oh, Kojima, type stuff to talk about. Talos Principle. Now, I played through the Talos Principle now. For those who are not aware of what it is basically a Portal game. It's Portal 3, essentially, made by the same people that did Serious Sam, Crow Team. And it is absolutely brilliant. I spoke to Steve about it briefly when I first started playing it. The early puzzles are unbelievably simple, but you know what they're like in these games. They handhold you for a little bit until you get used to how it works. But because all of us have played Portal, we know how those kind of mechanics work. It gets really, really complex. Now, you've played it, Steve. Have you completed it, though?
No, I haven't completed it. I'm just looking now to see how far...
Remind me, because we've talked about the Talos Principle before. Is it the one that's in black and white?
Right, no. Hang on. So
there was a couple of first-person Portal-y type games that we've talked about.
So the Talos Principle is a... It's a first-person game where you basically have a number of different tools, and those tools all do slightly different things. Now, I'm running through an early-ish level here. those things there are bombs, and they'll explode if you go near them. But there's loads and loads and loads of Easter eggs in it, and there's loads of little secret areas, which makes it really intriguing and makes you want to complete it. There's one Easter egg in it where it's just, you don't need to do anything. You don't actually need to do anything to do with it, but it's really, really complicated to get to it. You have to. The actual Easter egg is something. It's something to do with Portal. It's like a nod to Portal, but there's nods to loads of indie games in there. There's lots of nods to Papers, Please in there. There's loads of Serious Sam references. There's actually Serious Sam in Carbonite in one place. It's quite funny.
They're like their Egyptian devils, don't they, Crota?
Yeah, well, it's the same engine. They do, but this is just one of a number of different levels. But it's not just that. The story in this is highly confusing. Especially because everything's in fragments all over the place, but it's really, once you get past a certain point and you understand what they're trying to do, it's really intriguing, and it makes it really. There's at the moment I'm trying to figure out a mechanic that you use for the rest of the game, and it's like, this is the first time I'd experienced it. It's a dead simple mechanic, and as soon as you figure it out, you're like, fuck's sake, why didn't I do that at the beginning? You know? And there's loads of that. But some of the later puzzles are insane, like really, really hard to get your head around. Some of them look really, really complicated, and you work them out instantly. Or I did anyway for some of them, but you know, I'm sure there's puzzles other people struggled on and I don't, and the vice versa. We have to be very careful. I mean, those bombs only feature in a very small... There you go, dead ass. You're essentially... It explores the idea of AI... and humanity, and how close to humanity, like, AI is.
Consciousness, who am I? I think, therefore I am. It's kind of quite philosophical.
It is very, yeah, it's very deep. It gets really complicated, but I would highly recommend it to anybody who's enjoyed Portal. Even if at the very beginning it feels a little bit weak, or it feels a little bit, I've done this before, it isn't, it's different. And there's quite a lot of choices. There's actually three different endings to it, and I've completed it with all three of the endings. I just reloaded a save and thought, oh, I'll go off here and do these puzzles instead. But they're all different, you know, again, they've all got slightly different bits. But it also leaves a lot of questions in your mind as well, and a lot of kind of... Because it's a philosophical game, it leaves a lot of, well, what actually did happen and stuff. Yeah, anyway, yeah, I won't go any more into it than that. But just suffice to say that the puzzles are really cool, and as you go further, you know, like you get the gel in Portal 2 later on in the game. Mm. There's loads of things like that. So there's loads of terminals lying around. There's also other characters in the game, but not bunny hopping everywhere as well.
You bunny hopping, yeah.
Yeah. It lends itself that even though you can't. Even though you don't go any faster, it really feels like you should bunny hop in this game for some reason. So I just jump everywhere, just bunny hop everywhere. I'm trying to find a level that isn't... I think I must have just recorded the Egyptian levels. Yeah, I did. But anyway, yeah, highly recommended. Highly recommended. It's lovely, it's brilliant, and it's really challenging as well.
And it's quite cheap.
Is it? Still?
But you can't bind Ender or something.
It's back up to 30 quid now.
Yeah, I got it for like maybe a tenner or less. It's to be fair, I'm not sure I'd pay 30 quid. Like, nip on the unmentionable sites. I'm sure they're on there for cheapness. I also played a bit of Besiege, which I noticed that everybody on the planet owns, but everyone's only played about 5 minutes of it.
I've completed it.
Okay, right, you've played 8 hours of it. You're the only person who's played 8 hours of it on the entire of Steam.
Yeah. I rock.
I haven't played the single player that much. There's only a few levels anyway, isn't there, available? But I've been messing around.
There's a couple of worlds now, I think.
No, there's only one.
Polybridge.
There's only one world, but there's upcoming, you know, there's updates coming out all the time. I downloaded a few things.
That's where I sent you that, a picture of that trebuchet I made, Lou.
Yeah.
So, Besiege is just basically a construction game. You construct siege weapons. I know it's fairly old now, so everyone kind of knows what it's about. This is someone's made a machine gun, but watch what happens. This happens with almost every Steam Workshop item, by the way. Or anything that you create as well. Falls over. breaks and then explodes, essentially. But that actually does work. It's got loads of cannons on it, and it just fires forward. But there's a number of other things as well that I've downloaded. I've got an AT-ST that actually works really well. I've got
the worst machine gun in the world.
I've got a dreadnought for Warhammer 40,000 as well. Let me just fast forward them. A big elephant. Just an elephant with rotating tusks.
Does it move?
Does it walk?
It does. It goes. It takes because of the way that people have had to design some of these things.
Yeah, the control systems. Like this.
It can allocate different buttons to do different things when you.
There's not like a standard motion. So if you put a motor on, you'll have a button to go clockwise and anti-clockwise. If you put a piston, there's buttons to extend and retract. So you've got to kind of use a combination of different keys to try and make it.
So it's playing co-op with something very fragile.
It is very much like co-op, yeah. But if you don't know what you're doing, I mean, generally, forward and back move wheels, and then there's O to fly, and then there's L to extend pistons. There we go. I'm just going like that. There's also a flying machine as well, a plane that I got.
Why does it explode?
I don't know. Well, there's a bomb right there, actually. There's a bomb right in front of you. Let's get to the next one. So it took me a while to figure out what the controls were for this. I spent about half an hour just pressing forward and back, not understanding why it wasn't moving. It was shift and control to move it. But I actually get it flying in a minute, so let's move it on a bit. There we go. Bit of movement. This is 25, 30 minutes of gameplay, by the way.
Yay, look at that.
He's in the stars.
Grand Theft Auto 3.
I'm trying to do a loop-the-loop and just face plant. There we go.
It's pretty. There he is. It was pretty impressive.
But that was, apparently that's one of the best planes on Steam Workshop, and it does fly pretty well, to be fair, but not much use for it. I just decided to set fire to everything as well. There's a button where you can just click on things to set them on fire.
Just like in real life.
Just like in real life. Come on, there's one more. Oh no, this is the Dreadnought. There's actually about 500 buttons from this, because any of you are familiar with a Warhammer 40,000 Dreadnought, it's got weapons all over the place, and they've tried to replicate that here. So they've got a rotating kind of spinning flying fist thing. They've got they've got a button that makes your leg fall off. Anyway, I did actually try to do some of my own siege weapons as well, but I did them the other day. but unfortunately, they're on my laptop. I downloaded this on my laptop first and played it downstairs while the missus was watching telly, and I was just sat there in hysterics. My own. I was making my own things. Here you go, he's the AT-ST walker. It works really well. It looks a bit dodgy. It looks a bit like it's got arthritis. Watch it.
Oh god.
Legs off. Come on.
It's kind of working. Hey, bloody hell.
It's really well put together, to be fair.
But the rebels must be shitting themselves.
All of them metal plates are really heavy, so I wouldn't be surprised that's why it's so slow.
That's pretty impressive, that.
It is. But you can do all sorts with it, and that's the thing. And Steve said, there is a single-player game to it, which I played a little bit of, but not loads. I mean, maybe I played 2 hours in all of the whole thing now. But yeah, enjoyed that. It was a good laugh, anyway, for a couple of quid again.
I'll have to show you some of my creations at the LAN party.
Yeah, I think you did before, actually, but now I can probably appreciate how much effort goes into them. Okay, next. Haha, yes. Viscera cleanup detail.
Oh, I love the look of this game.
It's really daft, and especially daft with sound on as well, because there's just this the premise of this game is that you walk around cleaning up after the events of another game. So this is actually Viscera cleanup detail Shadow Warrior. And after Shadow Warrior being a, you know, Japanese kind of samurai game, you run around, there's just heads all over the place and body parts. And the point is you pick them up and you have to clean every last speck up. Now, Sel saw me playing this the other week, and she came in and she said, "You'll spend 2 hours doing that, but you're not. You won't do any housework."
Yeah.
Virtually.
To be fair, the house isn't covered in corpse pieces.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Otherwise, I think you would be involved.
You know,
say to her, like, if you want to have like a Kill Bill style sword fight in here, I'll gladly clean up the severed limbs afterwards.
It's actually quite a good game as well, this, though, because there's quite a few different mechanics in it. The first one's the mop. You have to clean things up with the mop. The mop gets dirty, so you have to clean the mop. And if you don't clean the mop, you make more of a mess. So, as you would in real life. It's not particularly accurate.
Just like cleaning my kitchen.
Yeah. Picking up someone's leg.
Put it in that box.
What do I do with this box? I can't quite get hold of this leg again for some reason. So the box ends up flying around. But you incinerate everything. You can go and get more mop buckets, and you can also go and get more containers to put things in. Once you've cleaned all of the bits up, you have to clean every speck of blood up as well. And if you miss one bit of blood, or you walk in a pile of blood, you make more mess. So you have to clean it, but you're timed on it as well. It's a lot of fun, you know. It's just daft.
Is this multiplayer? I seem to recall it was.
I think it is, yeah. I'm up for playing it multiplayer for you guys. I've had this for ages, and I don't know where I got it from. I might have got it in a Humble Bundle.
I'm sure you showed me this at our LAN.
No, I showed you it when I was at your house a couple of weeks ago.
I would have multiplayer version of this work. You race to clean up the room faster than you did the guy.
You just basically go. It's leaderboard stuff.
I saw one of the levels, which was a space station. I'm sure I saw it ages ago. Our LAN.
It wasn't me that was playing that.
Right, might be an Aussie, but yeah, I have seen this before.
But yeah, I know it's old, but I just played it over the holidays, so it's a bit of fun.
It was a multiplayer game that I was quite fancying playing with. Well, anyone who wants it. Have you seen Who's Your Daddy?
Nope.
Is this one of your scary games, Steve?
No, what do you mean my scary? I haven't got any scary games.
I've heard Who's Your Daddy.
It's basically a game where there's a parent and a baby. And it's like two players, so one person plays a parent, one person plays a baby. The baby's job is to try and kill itself.
Oh, it's a Kickstarter game.
Yeah, has got to stop it. So it's like a versus where you're trying to protect the child, but the child's trying to injure itself.
I like that.
Like real life.
You say it's multiplayer. Yeah,
just like
it's individual on Steam. The papers are like this.
Did you say it's multiplayer?
Yeah.
Again, I'm up for playing some of that.
It's $23.99 as well.
This is a similar idea, isn't it? You've got to go around like fixing and cleaning everything so that the baby
can't... Yeah, there's nothing dangerous about.
That's brilliant. I like that. It's baby's crawling in the oven at the moment.
That's all right, girl.
So somebody's the baby. That's even better.
Yeah, yeah. There's a father and a baby both playing at the same time.
Oh, wonderful! Just two people then.
I think so.
I just gonna have like twins and both parents.
That's
to cover up sockets and stuff. That's brilliant.
The baby's closed the oven door on itself.
You go, what's this?
How much trouble would they get in for this shit?
He's going to put a padlock on the oven door.
Oh.
I'm quite surprised that the...
Don't lock him in.
I'm quite surprised that people haven't kicked off about this.
Probably have.
All right, Indy.
Yeah, Indy
so was Hatred, but that got a lot of... didn't it?
Well, that was just sick for the sake of it, though, wasn't it? There was no real game there, apparently. It was just...
Apparently, it was part of a repetitive game, but it was playable. It just was a bit bland and boring, apart from the violence.
I love this. I think it's a brilliant idea.
This looks like a really good, fun game.
Playing this, Steve. I might even do some streaming of it.
The baby's in the bath now, film it.
Yeah, anyway. Yeah, good.
I mean, I'm sure it'll probably get very old very quickly, but it's only £4.
Oh yeah, of course.
Just for a laugh, eh?
Marzi wants it as well. Marzi wants to play it on Steam. Anyway, right. So moving on. Next one: Binding of Isaac Rebirth. Have any of you heard of this?
I've heard of Binding of Isaac. It's like a cross between a like Smash TV and.
It's not really. It's nothing like Super Meat Boy, but it's done by the same designer, yeah. Edward McMillan. I played it a little bit when I first got it, and I was a little bit like, oh, it's a bit boring, samey, you know. But I played it a little bit more since, and it is fairly good. It's got quite a lot of, it's quite addictive. And there's lots and lots and lots of power-up types in it. None of them make any sense. You need to really understand Edward McMillan's brain in order to understand what he's trying to achieve with each of them. But and half the enemies don't make sense either. I mean, these are like...
Screaming heads.
Your own heads or something. But the whole, again, the premise is that you're Isaac, this kid, and you've been... And your mum wants to kill you, so you jump down the basement, and that's it.
I've seen a speedrun of this, and it's really interesting. It's like, there's lots of ways that you can complete the game and play the game. It's procedurally generated to a certain degree as well, isn't it?
Yeah, well, 100% procedurally generated. I mean, there's obviously the same enemies all
including
over the place,
the power-ups and the combinations of power-ups. Yep. So it looks quite interesting.
Yeah, that power-up I've got there, again, it doesn't make sense, so you have to play it quite a lot to understand what all of the power-ups do. That power-up there, it seems to build up over time, and I don't quite know how. It could be as you kill enemies, or as you get damaged. After a certain time, you seem to get like star power, like in Mario, and you're invincible, and you can run into enemies and kill them. But I didn't really figure out, you know, you die before you figure out what half of the things do. There's lots of boss fights as well.
Larry.
Yeah, Larry Jr. I think I've maybe only got up to the third or fourth level. I haven't played it that much yet. But again, I think this power-up kicks off for the first time now. And I don't know what it does, otherwise I'd have been able to run into the boss and kill it. There you go. I'm just flashing and I'm like, what the fuck's going on? Just running around the level. Not really. And then as soon as I figure it out, I've run into him and it runs out. So, but yeah, it is. That's a good description there. It's a Smash TV kind of thing.
I like the look of this. It looks casual. And
it is very, very casual. You can have my copy if you want. I don't know if I'll play it that much. Yes.
Okay.
So what's the difference between this and the original then? What makes a Rebirth version? Is it like HD? Is it more levels? Is it...
No, there's Afterbirth as well. I think is Rebirth is the original and Afterbirth is a new one, I think.
Alright, okay.
But I don't know what the
standard one as well, isn't there? It's just the Binding of Isaac.
Yeah, this original
Binding of Isaac, Afterbirth, and then Rebirth.
I just don't know what the difference is between the versions. I'm sure someone does. Mythalos says it's inspired by Zelda. We can kind of see that as well, yeah.
Yeah,
it
does have a Zelda. You can feel like kind of Nintendo influences, but with kind of a big pieces of poo everywhere and lots of blood.
Lots of blood.
Okay, moving on. So another game I've been playing quite a lot of is City Skylines, which is fairly old, and I know Steve's played a lot of this as well.
Have you got the day and night DLC?
What does that mean? What does it do?
It gives you day and night.
I have day and night, so
you must have it, haven't you?
I just got it on the sale, so I assume I've already got that, yeah. Really quite complicated, especially when you get big cities. But also very simple in places as well. You can make it very easy for yourself if you lay your city out in a certain way and figure out how, you know, all the road systems work, etc. I still can't quite figure out how to get a motorway. Sorry, not a motorway, what do they call them? Highway. How to get a highway connected to...
You have to do an off-ramp. Like, you've got selected there.
Mm.
That's the only way you can do it, really. You put an off-ramp.
So,
and then put an on-ramp.
But when
you've got off and on ramp in both lanes.
Like I've done that. I've actually got off and on ramps going on. But when you get quite a lot of traffic going on the highways, how do you make that a 6-lane off ramp? Because as soon as you do that, it adds in stops and.
Yeah. So what you can do at that point is you do what you do in real life. You have off ramps gradually going down the motorway.
Oh.
So if you have one off ramp, then everyone's going to try and get in your city via that way. So you can have multiple motorways, multiple off-ramps, going to different districts. So you have all your heavy traffic and industrial stuff going to your industrial zone, residential zone, commercial.
Yeah, yeah. I've played a bit with districts and restricting traffic and stuff, but I haven't played that much with it. But
thing you can do as well is introduce other transport methods. So put like railway networks in, freight haulage, put like cargo haulage from boats and all that type of stuff in, and that'll reduce the amount of traffic you're getting from the motorway.
That looks cool. That looks like I haven't played the new SimCity, but it's apparently this is better than the new SimCity.
This is leagues.
This is very, very detailed, and I quite like that. I like the fact that the pollution, for example, if you
that looks like Beijing.
Normally, your pollution in SimCity, it'll just be around your industrial area, and that'll be pretty much it. But here, you've got different grades of pollution that occur, and they increase and decrease over time depending on what you use. One thing is, if you've got your waste pipes going downstream from, this is something that happened to me yesterday. If you've got your waste pipes going downstream from your water inlets, they will take in sewage immediately, and people will start dying or start.
And your hospitals will start getting overrun and all that stuff. One thing I've noticed to you, Chris. Hmm. Is that you've got shed loads of junctions but no roundabouts.
Oh, I know, this is actually a very old city. I've got a much better city now. But
they don't have roundabouts in America, do they?
They do, but they're just not called
roundabouts. In a few places, not very many places. Come in Sedona, weirdly.
See, I've got one on my laptop, which is massive. I think this is on my PC. But yeah,
have you got into the terrain edit yet? Have you made your own map?
No, not yet, no.
Frustrating thing about that is I created a huge map, like the full size scale, which you can get a mod to open up so you can actually build your city that size as well, and I wanted to put like a waterfall in there, just for aesthetic reasons, but I wanted to put different water levels in so I could produce hydroelectric power, create a big dam. The only problem with that is that you've got to get the water full flowing to the right levels before you can place a dam down, which means that in the level creator you basically got to put it on fast forward for the best part of 20 minutes, half an hour, in order to get the water fully flowing through all your like subsidiaries going out over, in order for you to be able to place hydroelectric power units. The problem with that is that as you modify the terrain and you say, right, okay, then let the water in, you leave for 20 minutes and realize that where you were going to build your like residential area is a floodplain.
Yeah.
Nice.
So then you've got to modify all the land, like take the water levels back down, then reintroduce the water. And it can be a little bit of a pain in the ass.
So it's because of the physics, basically. They have to do it that way, yeah. No, I haven't played it yet, but I think I might have a go of it. I think it's one of those games that every time I play it, I'd have to start again, because I'll probably leave quite big gaps in between my cities. But now I'm, again, getting... I mean, I'm done much better in the second city that I've done, you know, than the first city, and... I figured out a lot more to do with how some of the mechanics work.
There's a couple of mods you can get that allow you. I think one's called a traffic tool or road tool, and it gives you much more finite control over your placement of your roads and lengths and angles and curvatures and what have you.
Right. Cool. But I like it. I really like it. I think it's a very good city simulation game, and I think the people who made Sims, is it EA that do SimCity? They're probably quite jealous of this game, I've got to be honest.
Yeah. So there's another contender in this kind of SimCity region, that's at Cities XXL.
Right, yeah.
But on every review you read, people just say don't bother, get Skylines.
I actually thought, from what I'd heard about Skylines, I actually thought that this was less detailed than it actually is. I was under the impression that you didn't really do that much city building in it. If you know what I mean, I thought it was more city management, you know, and you just took over. But I'm obviously wrong there. I didn't know it was as detailed as this. I've lost about, let's say, see on my Steam library. Hang on. See Skylines. I've played 13 hours of it already. I know you've played probably a lot more than that, but
I'm on 61.
Yeah. I played 13 hours plus all these other games. This is this has probably had the most attention recently, I would say. It's good, though. If you like that kind of thing, go for it. I always seem to get with these games, though, that you get to a certain point where I can't be arsed anymore. My city's too big and too complicated, and one little thing that goes wrong. Like, for example, I put a dam down in front of my... I had my pipes and my waste in the right place, but I put a dam down in front of my waste pipes, and then it started backing up the pollution into my inlet pipes, but it took about 2 years for that to happen.
Yeah.
And it was like, fuck's sake, when it actually did happen, everyone in my city got sick, and I was like, what's going on? What's wrong? And I couldn't quite figure out why they were getting sick, you know? You just, you know, you learn how all of it works.
Yeah. One of the good things about City Skyline is the Steam community, the workshop, the amount of assets that are on there now is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Any amounts of buildings, they're like copies of real buildings, and then there's ones that people modify their own. So, you know, like the pump house that you get.
Yeah.
To pump the water. There's one on there that's like 10 times the capacity, slightly larger, but an industrial unit.
Great.
So instead of having loads of little ones, you're going to have a really big pump house plumped down.
Yeah, that's cool. I've seen quite a few... I haven't actually started playing with the unique buildings much yet.
All right.
Because they add certain value to different areas, don't they? But I've seen quite a lot of, you know, popped up on my Steam. Just I haven't been into the workshop, but I've seen the quite a lot of unique buildings popping up. And yeah, I think I'll play it a little bit more than I have done.
Good game.
Okay, moving on. So we'll get to the end of my list at some point, I promise, guys.
End of the show, probably.
Yeah, yeah. So next game I've been playing is a game called Door Kickers. Which, again, I've had on my wish list for quite some time because I like the look of the video. But it's a top-down perspective Rainbow Six, essentially. You plan your routes and you plan how to get into hostage situations and buildings. You can upgrade all of your guys as well. You can lock, you know, use lockpicks. You can throw flashbangs into rooms. You can use spy cameras. And you can, if you see what I'm doing now, I'm actually telling my second guy to run into the middle of the room, because that's what you do, dead sensibly, instead of running along a wall or getting behind some cover. It's quite brutal as well. There's one level I'm stuck on at the moment where you have to, it takes you to do a full level, sometimes it might take you 10-20 seconds because you pause your game as you're running through the level.
It looks a bit like Frozen Synapse, in that you kind of plan the moves out and it... Yeah,
it's easier than, well, I say easier, it's more forgiving than Frozen Synapse and looks a bit better. This is 2D though. I mean, it looks a little bit 3D, but it is definitely a 2D game. Frozen Synapse, I think, is kind of a 2.5D game, but I enjoyed Frozen Synapse as well, but this is a little bit more accessible, let's say. It's actually, I think it was actually released as a pad game, iPad game originally. Anyway, I'm quite enjoying it. It's one of them, again, casual games I'm just kind of jumping into. But so there's one level at the moment that's really quite annoying, and it's it takes you maybe 30 seconds to get into one of the rooms, and as soon as you go into that room, no matter how you enter it, unless you're pinpoint accurate and you've upgraded all of your staff to a certain level, all the hostages get shot within a second of you, like, not even a second, within a millisecond of you opening the room. If you throw a flashbang in, before the flashbang goes off, they all get shot. If you just barge through the door or use a breaching charge, the hostages die because they're right near the bloody door. And it's like, how the hell am I supposed to do it? I don't know if it's broken or not. Probably isn't broken, but it's good anyway. I'd again recommend it. It was dead cheap. I've had it for a while, if you like that kind of thing. Tactical, top-down shooty games. Gets quite deep as well. You get different classes of staff, etc. You can choose, you know, you choose shield guys with shields. You can customize all of their infantry. But yeah, go for that. Okay, nearly there actually. I think I've got two more games to talk about. One I talked about a while back, the Beginner's Guide. got this on the sale, and I know a few people in chat have also been playing this as well. I know Mythalor has been playing this a little bit. Have you heard of it first, guys?
No.
So you've heard of the Stanley Parable, yeah?
Yeah.
So it's the same guy that did the Stanley Parable. But what this is it's a more of a narrative experience. You can't die in it. I know Stanley Parable is a narrative, but it's more that explores the choices and consequences and the psyche of the kind of human being. Whereas this one has a story, which is, it basically starts off with, I met this guy once, and he, obviously the guy narrating does a better job than I'm going to do here, but I met this guy once. He does he used to create games, and he stopped creating them, and his games were really, really interesting, and he takes you through all of his games, and he shows you all of these games that this guy made in the Source Engine. This is, I think this is one of them. I think it is, yeah. And they've all got a theme to them, and the narrative kind of moves on, and it's quite deep. Anyway, if you like a narrative game, if you like the Stanley Parable, if you like Gone Home and Ethan Carter's, and those kind of games, then it'd be for you. If you don't like that and you want a game, then don't bother, because it's very much, you listen to the guy and he just takes you through it, and it's very surreal. A lot of the levels are very creative, let's say. They're very surreal and strange. But the story, I mean, I've completed it. It's only a short game. It's actually short enough for me to get a refund on Steam if I wanted to. Not that I'm going to, because I said it was only a few quid in the sale, and I like this guy's work, so I'm more than happy paying for it. But yeah, go for it if you're interested.
Yeah, I really liked Stanley Parable.
Yeah, it's quite different. It's not, it doesn't have as much content as the Stanley Parable, and it's certainly not funny like the Stanley Parable can be. It's definitely more of a thinking game, and it's actually, there's a number of different ways that you can interpret the ending and interpret the game, in fact. Because if you think about it, this guy is putting out games. He's compiled a list of games that another game developer has put together, which is illegal if you think about it, because he hasn't got his permission.
Right. Don't know. That's... it might be counted as fair use. Well, no, he's charging for it, isn't he?
Yeah. So it's not fair use at all. But
hang on, do you mean that he's in real life has taken other people's games, or is it
right,
the character has taken other characters' games?
I can't say any more than that, otherwise I'll spoil the experience for people who play it. But that's basically the premise of the game. Is there's a lot of weird shit going on in the games. There's lots of themes going on. The narration is very strong. All this time that I'm walking around, in fact, the very first thing you see in the game is make sure your sound is on, because you can't play the game without sound. It doesn't, just watching it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. You need to be listening to what the guy says.
Yeah, I'm watching it and it's not making any sense.
Yeah, I mean, this is the only level that there's seems to be a fail state on, and it's like you have to do things in a very certain specific order in order to get past this particular bit, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on?
Ask that, actually, if you have any agency, or if you're just involved in a 3D story, essentially.
It's one of those games that I played, you are involved, there's a bit of agency, but it's not particularly, it doesn't matter. Like, I die about 8 times during this level, because I'm like, what the fuck is going on? I literally have no idea what I'm doing. But that was the point. As you listen to the guy, as you go through the levels, you will pick it up eventually. There's again, lot. Anyway, I'm going to stop showing content now, because I don't want to spoil it for anyone who does want to play it. And I'm going to stop talking about it. But give it a go if you like intriguing games. I've also been playing The Vanishing of Ethan Carter Redux, which is another story narrative game. It seems to be, I didn't really know what it was about, but it seems to be a murder mystery of some sort. To some extent, but it's a very, very nice looking game. Dear Esther, that's the other one that I keep thinking about as well.
Yeah, I played a bit of that and didn't like it.
I haven't got it myself. I've never played that. But this is This does have, it doesn't seem to be any death in it. There's lots of invisible walls in the game. But it's very, again, you have to listen to what the guy's saying to really follow it, but it doesn't, I think it says again right at the beginning, it doesn't hold your hand. It takes you through a story. I haven't completed it yet. I've only played a few hours today, actually, of this missing kid. It actually took me about 3 or 4 of the main puzzles to figure out how the main puzzles worked. And we started the show, I went back to the first puzzle. It took me about an hour to walk back to the first puzzle because it's a fucking huge world, considering the speed that you walk. And I went back to finish off the first puzzle because there's things that happen when you've completed them.
Bad looking game.
It's lovely looking as well. Yes, yeah. It's for indie as well. I mean, it's an indie game. Yeah. It's beautiful.
Really nice.
There's lots of weird stuff going on as well. There seems to be some, what's the word? Not psychological.
Supernatural.
Supernatural type feeling to it. Anyway, it feels kind of like. Oh, that game that I played on the Wii. I played it on the 360. Alan Wake. It feels like Alan Wake, but it doesn't look like that at all.
It looks very nice.
It's beautiful. I'm playing it in 4K here as well, and it's running at 40 odd FPS on my 980. I only played it in 4K because the window mode options are very strange in it. And if I played it in window mode, I couldn't record
it. Is it just PC exclusive, this game?
I'm not sure. It might be on PlayStation 4 now. Again, it's a narrative experience, though, so it's more... And I'm quite enjoying this era of indie game because it's different from just playing Call of Duties and playing, like, you know, your kind of standard computer game. These are actually telling stories. These are concise books that are telling me and allowing me to experience a world without the narrator or without the writer having to tell me that this rock was had orange moss on it, you know? It's nice to experience this beautiful world. And Gone Home was similar as well. It didn't look as nice as this, but it still had a really nice aesthetic to it. And I felt like I was in the shoes of the person I was playing. And this, I'm not sure who I'm playing. I'm not sure the guy. I kind of get the impression that you're the detective of some sort. I think pretty much you are the guy that's going to help them, but he's saying all kinds of things whilst he's narrating that make you think that he's not quite who you think he is. And yeah, it's interesting. Again, some people have already played this and played it through, but it's bloody gorgeous looking.
Let's
see if I can just scroll on to another bit of the environment. Oh, here we go. There's one of the first puzzles, and it's like, what the fuck's going on? Except it doesn't give you any hints as to what to do, but you do have to find things, and there are puzzles in it, but they're not really, really difficult. They're just a little bit abstract. It's probably
what engine's that using?
I don't know, you know. It could be the Cry engine if it's that pretty.
I think it's their own engine. I'm just looking at an article about how they did it. They basically scanned real objects out in the wilderness, like trees and rocks and stuff, and used them to build the game.
Was in like point cloud data?
Kind of turned into 3D models, but there's no repeating textures and stuff. It's photogrammetry, I think it's called.
Right. Well, that's interesting. That's I didn't know.
Cool
that.
Technique. Obviously, it looks good.
Yeah.
It looks very, very, very real. The characters in it, you know, you do see one or two characters, and they're not brilliant, but it doesn't really matter with the context it's in.
I find that a game, I think, is it Dear Esther, where you just literally walk around an island and pick up old letters?
Yeah, Gone Home does that as well. That's basically.
Is it Gone Home? Is that the one I'm thinking of, or are they both the same?
I think Dear Esther's probably the same, but you do that in this as well. You pick up letters and notes. Well,
I don't mind it so much, but I think the idea of having a couple of puzzles to solve is... I mean, I don't want to restrict what the medium can do, but I want a little bit of gameplay in my game. There was a game that came out a while ago called... Everyone's Gone to the Rapture on PlayStation.
Yeah, I want to play that.
And again, but it just looked like you walk around a town and look at and listen to some ghosts talking, and then that's all you do for the game. There's nothing else to it. You can't interact with anything other than these ghostly whispers, and I'm like, well, I can't really be bothered with that, just walking around somewhere slowly, listening to ghosts.
Well, that's what I was just saying. It's not a game. It's not a traditional game. It's a story. It's a book that you play. And I don't mind that if it's interesting, you know. I mean, if it gets good reviews, I'm gonna get it, because I quite like the fact that I know that I'm going to spend 2 hours and I'm going to get the end of that story and I'm going to get some kind of conclusion, you know. And that's good for me. I don't mind paying a couple of quid for that kind of experience. I'd rather do that than read a full book these days, because I don't have that much time to read a full book. And I can't read.
Ironically, although I haven't been playing that many games, I have read quite a few books.
Yeah, well, it's easy to do that, isn't it? It's easy to say, I'm reading a book, to your family, then go.
I'm just going to go upstairs and ignore yourself for the next 3 hours. Yeah. That environment looks really nice.
It is very pretty. Really nice. Everything you see as well in the distance, you pretty much go to all that as well. Anyway, again, don't want to spoil too much for people. Yeah. But I'm playing through that myself at the moment. Oh, where's my mouse gone? There it is. And that is it.
Oh, cranky. That took a while, did it?
Oh, the only other one was Life is Strange. I played a demo of Life is Strange. Because I talked about that in the last show, I think. And from that, I got it in the Steam sale, and I got all of the episodes. I think there's 5 episodes. I think they were like £2 an episode, but it worked out a little bit cheaper if you got them all as a bundle. So I got them all. I haven't played it all the way through yet, but I played the demo, and it's quite cool. Play with time in it, and even though as an angsty teenager, you run around and kind of stare at things. It's
That's the Unreal Engine 4.
All right, okay. Just texturing, though, isn't it? I mean, remember that this PBR stuff. Excuse me. Forgotten what PBR stands for now.
Physical based rendering.
Physically based rendering. That's it. Sorry. So physically based rendering is a lot nicer looking, and it's now in all of, you know, it's now in all the engines, and it's becoming quite popular for people, because it's a little bit easier to design systems, but people are probably getting used to it as well by now.
With the Vanishing of Ethan Carter, basically what they did is took loads of photos of things from different angles, and some software generates a 3D model and the textures.
Mm.
And then the artists just tweak the models, make them low poly, and put the textures back on them, and you end up with a 3D representation of what you took pictures of. The more pictures you take, cool. The more complicated the model gets, or the more detailed the model gets.
Cool.
So could you do the same thing with, like, high-definition video camera? If you were to pan it around, would you get, like, a uber-detailed model from it?
Not as good as from very high-quality photography. 4K. That's still not comparable to, like, a 50-megapixel camera. But, yeah, that's the general idea of the technique they use in it.
Mm. I just want to say as well that thing we just watched is Redux. It's Ethan Carter Redux. So
yeah, it's the Unreal and 4 version.
Was the one that not Unreal 4?
Sorry?
Was the normal version of it not Unreal 4 then?
Doesn't look like it.
Right. Probably the Unreal Engine though, I imagine. It'll be the physically based rendering that they've changed probably.
Yeah.
From Unreal 3 to 4. Anyway, so yes, moving on. We were going to have a section on the most anticipated games of 2016, but I'll be honest with you, I don't think we're going to have time now, are we? Because I've been wittering on for an hour or an hour
we'll
and
get,
a half about
as
the
as they
games.
Come out, we'll talk about them then, I guess.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's quite difficult. I have to be honest, it's quite difficult for me to say what I'm looking forward to, because I don't really know what's coming out, I have to be honest.
Plus, most of them that I could think of, that I just had a quick look on, like, a game site, and I made a little list for myself in a document, just so that I wouldn't forget titles, which I did. I went and looked and was like, oh, I forgot that's coming out this year. Like, I forgot that the new Mass Effect game is slated for release this year, because there's been so little promotion of it so far. There's so little information.
There's a new Mass Effect game.
Yeah, Mass Effect Andromeda. I don't know what they're doing. I don't know. Apparently, it's a full-on Mass Effect game, so it's not like it's a spin-off or anything. But I don't have any idea if it's to do with Shepard. It's called Andromeda, so one would assume it's in the Andromeda Galaxy, not the Milky Way Galaxy, which means it could be a completely new set of everything.
Well, that was the point, isn't it? They're going to be in a different... I think that's what they're doing. They're doing it in another galaxy. And
so it's sort of like a reboot almost, but with the same...
Different people, although I imagine some of the original Mass Effect cast might appear.
Well,
yeah,
I don't know, because in the Mass Effect universe, they use the Mass Effect relays to get around within the Milky Way. There's but nothing that allows them to travel outside that.
But they're gone, aren't
they? They are gone.
Yeah. So unless they've discovered a new technology or...
They have, and that's the thing. That there's been a few things that have been leaked. Not leaked, or they've released, rather. They've tactically released. And there's another way to get around the galaxy, but it's not mass relays anymore. But I don't think it's... I don't know. I don't know the detail surrounding it.
Well, I've enjoyed all the Mass Effects so far.
On my list, but it's not something that there's that much concrete detail of yet. There's not even a proper trailer for it, I don't think. Maybe a teaser.
A couple of the games that I'm really looking forward to. There's XCOM 2, which I think is going to be good, because I really enjoyed the remake. I know Lou didn't really get
it. I loved it.
Lou?
Yeah?
Yeah. He's still with us.
Sorry, still there.
I didn't realize you were asking me a question.
And also, if any of you seen the... any information about Far Cry Primal?
I've seen a trailer for it, and it looked, as an idea, I thought, that's kind of like interesting and different.
Yeah.
At least it's not just... I hope it's not just go and get the towers hang gliding again, but this time in Tibet, not in Tropical Island. There is a mechanic in it, though, that was in Far Cry 4, which is to control the animal. You get in Far Cry 4, there are these like druggy trip things that you go on.
Yeah.
And you have control of this like white tiger that you can send to attack things. And it looks like they've taken that and sort of spread that out into a main mechanic with the different beasts that you can interact with. I've seen a trailer for it. And I have to say, I don't know why they're calling it Far Cry, because it looks like a completely... They should... Well, it's just because they want to have name recognition, but it looks nothing like the other Far Crys. You're basically a caveman with what looks like a spear and the ability to like talk to animals and control them and use them. That looks like the basic... I don't even know if you've got a bow and arrow maybe in it.
So maybe it's basically like Turok.
Turok was like sci-fi, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, high-tech
Savage Lands
and stuff.
Or Ark.
This looks like it's firmly like old school. Like you don't have any high-tech weapons. You've got like a spear and maybe a rudimentary bow and arrow. And your ability to control the animals. I think that's where the real meat of the game is going to be, in how you use the different creatures to what effect and things like that. And I don't even know what the enemies are all going to be like. There is a trailer that just shows other like cavemen type dudes, but there'll probably be other things as well, like taking down big beasts and stuff with your pack of wolves or whatever you've got.
I was reading about today that it's going to be single player only as well.
Yeah.
Well, did we get that much out of Far Cry 3 multiplayer? We didn't really.
Not really, because it wasn't really the same game, was it?
It was on rails kind of co-op, wasn't it? It wasn't brilliant.
Yeah. And each level was the same, basically.
Yeah, just kill a load of enemies. You can't stealth them.
Just reading a Wikipedia article about Far Cry Primal, and one of the sentences starts, "Players can tame wildlife such as prehistoric badgers."
Oh, nice. I'm in. Sold.
As you were. Did you play Far Cry 4, though?
I didn't like it at all.
So the honey badgers are in there.
Honey badgers,
they're one of the huntable.
I think I do remember them, actually. The only thing I remember from that game mainly is those bloody eagles. Oh, look, an eagle's attacking my eyes again.
Those eagles can fuck off. Right to the end of the earth, anyway.
So, yeah, there's a few other games that you've got down there that I'm anticipating as well. Deus Ex, Mankind Divided. Can't wait for that. I love the new Deus Ex reboot, and I can't wait for more of the same. Zelda, new Zelda game for the Wii U or Nintendo NX. Can't wait for that. First HD Zelda ever. Big open world. Big as the Wii U can handle, they keep saying. So we'll see.
Unfortunately, it won't be on the Wii U.
Probably not. And The Last Guardian, which, you know, it's just a different type of puzzle game. Kind of that. Wistful.
Yeah, I think it's a puzzle adventure sort of game. A bit like, I think it's, I'm hoping that it does what the Shadow of the Colossus did, but expands on it more.
Yeah.
Which is the idea of the and to an extent eco as well, which is the sort of like you're going from a journey from A to B with a companion, and it's about the bond that forms as well. You depend on each other. What they showed in that trailer, that E3 trailer, was how they both depend on each other. And I really like that, and if they can make that into some cool mechanics and not just narrative stuff, then I think it could be a fucking awesome game. That's probably because it's technically a new IP. That's probably my most anticipated game of next year. But there are quite a lot of games that I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, quite a lot. I mean, without looking, you mentioned Dishonored 2 as well. Again, quite happy to play another Dishonored game.
Yeah.
But anyway, shall we move on to the news? Because we've got quite a lot of news as well. We'll try and condense it into one. So, first of all, there's been lots of VR news that we mentioned at the beginning of the show.
Yeah, today, CES started today, so...
CES?
CES, the big expo.
Yeah.
Oh, did it? Oh, right, sorry.
Yeah.
That explains why there's a lot of news coming out. So, yes, all the VR giants are battling against each other for the best specs and the earliest release dates and the cheapest price. Well, they're not battling for the cheapest price, definitely, because we've got some news today that the Oculus Rift is available from pre-order from today onwards.
Yeah.
And it's $599. And you are going to get it March or later. Now, at the time of writing, it was up to, or at the time I wrote this, it was up to May. So, you know, they're going to ship them in units, I think, in bulk. So they were going to ship so many in March, then April, then May. And I was watching the screen, and people obviously booking enough of them. Unless there's a very small amount, it's still quite popular, regardless of that price. Now, what do you guys think of this price then? $599, which is around about £410, but it works out at £499 at checkout.
I think that's pretty damn steep, to be honest. I think it's kind of sweet the deal by throwing an Xbox One pad in there, but I just don't see...
Not just that, they've got two games involved. There's two games there, Xbox One and, which is pretty cool, I think, and this is considering the price that they've just released, but everyone's already forgotten about this. They've decided a few days ago that everybody that got the software development kit via Kickstarter, so this, Lou, unfortunately this doesn't apply to you because you bought it after the Kickstarter, are going to get a free version 1 of the Oculus Rift, which is a bit gutting. Yeah,
that's quite cool.
It is very cool, that, I think, and I think you have to give them props for that, because that's still a lot of freeness that they're giving away, but they're easily going to make that up with a 500 quid on our side, $600 on the American side.
Well, not necessarily easily make it up with all the competition they've got. I mean, I think the one that gamers are looking at the moment is the Vive.
Yes, but just bearing in mind that it's still at May 2016. So that means, I mean, I don't know how many they can ship per month or how many they're planning to ship per month, but 3 months have filled up already. March, April. Wow. Actually, two and however months have filled up already.
What has struck me is I was looking at the specs for the new Oculus Rift and the Vive, and they're, physically speaking, the same specs, the same resolution, the same frame rate.
Hmm.
Obviously differences in the way they're tracked and stuff, but I don't think that... I think he's splitting hairs with that. I think it's going to be...
There's
pretty good for presence regardless.
There's one thing that the Vive has announced in the last week, a couple of days ago, that does trump the Oculus Rift, and that is they now have a forward-facing camera that tracks and ghosts all of the objects that is in front of you into the VR world at the click of a button. So you press a control pad button or something, and you can see in your VR headset without having to take it off what's in front of you. So
that's a really cool feature, I think.
It's a problem with VR, and if they do it right, that could trump the Oculus Rift.
That is a good idea. Yeah, they've also got other stuff in the Vive, haven't they? They've got something called the Chaperone, which basically maps the room and identifies things and basically stops you bumping into things or tripping over things or...
Well, same thing, basically, apart from it's now visual within the headset as well. Well,
yeah, I think that's what the next thing about it.
Not only that, from the practical thing of like having to be aware of what your actual physical environment has got around you. I think it's just good to know. There's a little bit of, what's the word I'm looking for? Like like a sense of displacement when I played on your Oculus Rift that one time.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of a, you feel your body is in a room, but your mind is in a different place because your audio and visual stuff is completely enveloped in the Rift. You kind of feel like your head's in one place and your body's in another, in a weird way.
Related to this, related to the whole VR thing, there's actually a new haptic feedback suit that's just went live on Kickstarter yesterday, I think it is, and it's done by Tesla. So Tesla are getting involved in other people who do the electric cars. And
how long before someone puts this on and plays Mortal Kombat and then gets both the kneecaps broken and
gets his spinal
torn? Oh yeah, because that's going to happen, isn't it? Yeah, it's going to simulate real life within the VR.
But why is it going to? Yeah, it's haptic feedback suit. That's exactly what
it's not going to be. Yeah. That
it's going to be a rumble pack in suit form. When you get hit, you'll go, it'll like judder a bit, and you'll be like, oh, I got hit.
It's not a rumble pack. It's electronic stimulation.
There's two variations of it. There's one that's got 30 channels, and there's one that's got 52 channels. The 30-channel one is the cheaper one, obviously, and the 52-channel one is more expensive. But I just want to point out one thing. I'm not getting one, but there's no groinal attachment.
That will change. They're leaving the market open for all the companies that know how to do that shit.
The only part of the body that doesn't have anything attached to it is your bum. You know, your bum has some on. In fact, there's little pulses that go on your bum, but not your groinal area.
Right up your sphincter.
Yeah, right up there. Anyway, that's a Tesla. What's it called?
There's the Prodigy and the Pioneer.
I'm slightly worried about the fact that Tesla did that, since I read just today that a Tesla car caught fire on a charging station. So I don't want to wear a suit, which might potentially...
It's got a belt around it.
Too far.
Yeah, this haptic feedback's really good. I feel really hot. Oh, shit, I'm fucking on fire.
And you can't see because you got the fucking VR headset on. And you're in a room in VR that's on fire, so... Yeah.
You're playing Fireman Simulator
really
or some shit.
Fireman Simulator? Backdraft the game.
Yeah. That's a game that's been needed to be made for a long time.
Yeah.
Russell.exe.
Anyway, it's a full... You can get trousers, you can get a top separate, or you can get a full bodysuit with the 52 or 30 channel option.
You've got to put down a minimum of £1,200 though.
I was just going to say, I think it's a minimum of $1,200, I think it was. Was it quid? No, Tesla's a UK company, so it'll be £1,200.
Plus it's interesting.
Do you not remember a while back when we were talking about VR and I said, we need full immersion and haptic feedback suits is the thing that I would go for. I'm not going to get it because it won't fucking fit me, for one. It's a really skinny... imagine sat there...
It's like a morph suit.
Yeah,
It'll be expandable, won't it?
I'll put a link in chat for people to the Kickstarter. Don't back them, but you know.
we need. I was going to say we need smell-o-vision, but then technically all of Fallout 4 would smell horrible.
I hope it doesn't look like that. They look shit.
Oh no! Look down. Look further down. The black ones.
Right, that's more like it.
But even that, imagine my fat rolls in that.
You'll have to be naked underneath it.
Yeah, exactly.
There are no... the Prodigy's got some on your bum. It's got like a worrying amount. It's got 12 things on your bum.
Imagine how smelly that suit's going
to
get,
though. That's what I mean.
You'll have to be able to wash it, surely.
It is machine washable, it does, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not convinced with it, but... ask for it, so...
It's got them on your nipples.
You don't need them, Lou, if you're doing that all the time. Anyway, so
basically it sends an electric pulse and makes that part of your body ripple like an ab cruncher or something.
Well, you know, yeah, the ab crunch is where they send electrical impulse in order to tense the muscle up. Mm. I think it works in the same principle.
I don't see that being very, I don't know, very...
Enjoyable?
Well, not just enjoyable, but just very convincing.
Imagine
that. Suddenly, like, your tits are flobbering.
I know, but they're not going to get it. Perfect the first time. This is a proof of concept almost, isn't it? It's the first step into a haptic suit.
You need a suit covered in pistons all pointing at your body, and it all just...
They need neural connections directly into your brain, so you don't have to wear a suit, you don't have to wear a bloody virtual reality headset. Then I might buy into it. Then I might be up for it.
that's where it's going to go, isn't it? This is the stuff that we're going to look back and say, look, what a clumsy idea, actually having to put sensors and electrodes all over your body.
We're going to have to jack into the internet at some point. It is going to be... I really want to see that day, but I'm also scared shitless of that day. That really far future science fiction stuff. And it will happen, because this is what we were saying before when we've talked about VR. VR is only going to work when it's... This is the first real... commercial success of VR. I mean, I'm going to say success. I'm going to put myself.
I was
going to
say, I have to jump the gun a little bit.
I think it's succeeding much more than the '90s version did.
'90s version was Lawnmower Man.
Yeah, and I mean, I went on a few VR simulators back in the day, and it was cool as a kid.
Virtuality.
But, yeah, I remember. I must have, when I was in America, I think I played something, and it was, you had to get in this circle thing, and you had a control pad, and you're just basically on rails and moving around.
And you had the helmet on, which had a CRT in front of it and a weight on the back so that it wouldn't fall forwards.
Yeah, I think I got about 2 or 3 inches smaller from using it. But it was quite expensive to do it as well, I think. I think it was like $30 or something to have a 2 minute go on this virtual reality thing. Back then, that would have been quite expensive. But yeah, it's just going to get more and more and more immersive. Games are the new films, and films are, you know, entertainment. People are now accepting games in a way that is going to push these technologies much, much further. It's a bit scary, but it's also a bit exciting. To me, anyway. So
it's an interesting development.
So talking about VR then, PlayStation VR has also announced its hardware. I don't think it's got prices out there yet. I might be wrong. Someone please correct me if I am wrong.
Have they actually... do you have some link to the specs? Is it...
So the spec for the VR, I haven't put a link into the chat document, but I think it's 960 res per eye, 960p per eye or something like that. Or it's one big res of 2560 or something. I can't remember exactly off the top of my head.
All right, but, so they've upped the res, because I remember the res being a big sticking point with the PlayStation VR. It was well behind the others.
It's also worth mentioning as well that the PlayStation VR needs an additional hardware for it to run with a PlayStation. So you're going to get a little Wii-sized box with it in order for a PlayStation VR to run. But I have a feeling it might be cheaper than the PC versions, but it might not be as good either, so we shall see. But it could be better, that's the thing. It could be more immersive.
I'd be surprised. I feel like if they're going to do like an add-on thing for a console, I don't think they get away with charging £500 for it.
No.
It's more than the console itself is going to cost you. People won't pay for it.
There's no way.
I think there's the people that are going to get the Oculus Rift is already your early adopter types who have the money to spend on that kind of stuff. I just think they're going to have a lower price bracket for the console. People just won't pay for it otherwise. Unless there's something that really sells it, like there's a game that comes out that is the, you know, virtual reality experience that you have to play. It's just not going to happen unless they charge £500.
I think I saw a figure saying that the PlayStation 4 has now shifted 37 million units as of the Christmas holidays. I think it had another 5.7 million or something over Christmas sold, which is a lot of fucking units, isn't it?
I think it's at the moment the most successful of this current generation in terms of consoles sold.
Yeah, definitely.
I can't speak to how its game sales are doing, because that's where they actually make their money. They don't make that much money on console sales.
Yeah.
They usually make their money on software sales. I don't really know who's doing that. There probably isn't that much between them all, really.
I have to be honest, I'm still glad of my decision at the moment to just be a PC guy. You know, again, I've gone back to my PC roots, and I seem to be playing more PC games than anything else, because I don't really feel like I'm getting much value for money from consoles at the moment because of the price of the games. 60 quid, 50 quid a title, and there's no way you can get a cheaper version. And I don't get that much more entertainment out of... well, I definitely don't get any more accessibility or anything from playing it on a console than I do on a PC. So I'm glad I decided to upgrade my PC and go with it that way, you know, this time around.
Who's just going to sell his PC and trade it all in for Costa coffee vouchers?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Bacon or something.
Oh, sorry, what is it you like? Pret-a-manger.
Oh, Pret-a-manger. Anyway, yeah. Other hardware news. AMD has revealed the new Polaris chipset for its new GPUs, which is 14 nanometers instead of the 28 nanometers, which is what... this is a die set or die cast or something. I'm not technical with the hardware, but it's the
size of transistors.
Yeah, it's the size of the basically the smaller the better. So 14 nanometers means they can fit more in, which means that they can make the GPUs more powerful. I think the latest Skylake CPUs. So these are computer CPUs are at, I think we're at 28, or we go a Skylake is 14 now, I think, maybe. So the GPUs are catching up to them, or they might even be less than that now, the Skylakes. I can't remember. I think I've got a Skylake myself, but I can't be entirely sure. But anyway, just the reason that I raised this at this point is because VR needs more power, or is going to need more powerful GPUs. Now, the spec that you need, a minimum spec that you need for an Oculus Rift, bearing in mind that you're paying 500 quid for the Oculus Rift in itself, you get a few extra peripherals with it and a few games and console controllers and stuff, but you're also going to have a PC that's worth, I would say, probably at least a grand in order to run it. You need a GTX 970, or was it the AMD 240 somethings? I don't know AMD GPUs that well. A GTX 970 is basically what Lou has, and Lou's not a gamer anymore. So, you know, it's when he was a gamer, that was a pretty good GPU, you know.
He used to be a gamer, now he's a lamer.
What are you on, Ste? You want a 970?
Question. I'm actually, I'm pretty close to an upgrade at the minute.
Because I was on a 960 and I upgraded to a 980. No, I was on a 680. Bloody, not 60. I was on a 680 and I upgraded to a 980. And I saw a big improvement from that.
See, I'm on a 770 GTX.
Right, so you won't be able to VR with that if you wanted to. And you need an i5 something.
I've got 7.
But then loads of RAM as well, 8 gig of RAM or something to that effect, just to run the Oculus. So you need a good PC in order to buy the VR kit. I think I might just wait until the next generation, you know, because the price will come down, they'll be better, there'll probably be a lot more games out that'll be in, or it'll have failed and we won't have missed out.
And you won't have to buy it, yeah, that's something. Yeah.
I think I'm going to. I'm not particularly an early adopter with most things anyway, but it's just too much, isn't it? That is just too much money, I think, to spend for now. I mean, I'm not horrified by the price because, you know, I was expecting it to be expensive, but it's gone up from what I thought. I actually thought it'd be around the 350 mark, I'll be honest.
I was thinking between 3 and 4, to be honest.
Yeah, I would have thought it'd been the same price as the DK2, to be fair, which was about 300.
But, anyway. Okay, so moving on to game news. Let's talk about the little things. Sorry, I'm very dry today. So there's a new story saying a gamer has kept his SNES on for 20 years to keep one of his save games intact. Now, you know that SNESs have some SNES cartridges have batteries inside, and if you leave them for too long, the battery runs out and you lose your save games. So he's kept this SNES on for 20 years in order to save a game because he wanted the memories from back then or some bollocks.
But it wouldn't need to stay on for 20 years, wouldn't it need to be on intermittently?
Well, the point is it hasn't been on constantly. The article goes into a bit more detail. and he's turned it off for power failures and moving house and things like that. But, you know, he's kept it on. Anyway, bit of daft news there for you.
What game file?
It's some Japanese title that I'm not interested in, so I can't remember what it was.
Interesting, the SNES characters just have a flat battery in them.
Yeah. You just have a small watch battery and.
Yeah, yeah. I thought they'd have some. Yeah, I didn't realise they actually have a interchangeable battery like that.
Yeah, so the battery was just used to save the ROM bit, but it's not in every cartridge. It's only in some of them, even though every cartridge had the capability of not using. I don't know. That's just what they did.
Strange.
There's a Fallout 4 Macho Man Randy Savage mod out, which has to be mentioned because there was a Skyrim version of it. And it's wonderful.
It is pretty funny. And it kind of works. Well, I don't know how, if you say works better is a subjective term. He seems less weird when it's Macho Randy Deathclaw than it was when he was a dragon. When he was a dragon, it was really odd. Whereas in this, it kind of works.
Yeah,
it's less jarring.
He's a better shape, let's say.
Yeah, it's a humanoid shape.
In fact,
least.
I'm going to put the.
There
what
it is.
The fuck?
I'm going to put the sound on.
Oh, yeah.
Who's that?
Oh, he doesn't exist anymore.
No.
I'm surprised they even allowed him to go on this video. That's how you deal with Deathclaws.
There's at one point there's about 20 of them all doing it.
I tend to run up Deathclaws in my head and punch them as well.
That's because you're hard.
That's what you do, isn't it?
Anyway, that's enough of that, but I just wanted to there's other little silly news. Man is suing Bethesda over a Fallout 4 addiction.
There's always someone, isn't there? There's always someone suing someone for making something good.
What is the world coming out?
There's always someone suing something, but basically, they made a product. I like your product too much. Give me money for liking your product too much. Fuck off, you twat.
Well, he's lost his family,
no
his girlfriend, his job.
Congratulations.
It's basically, I refuse to take responsibility for my actions. You're going to pay for my, problems. Well,
it's like suing McDonald's for getting fat. You know, it's the same.
No one likes suing McDonald's for getting fat.
It's ridiculous. Anyway.
Fucking stop eating there. Turn the game off, you idiot.
A fan has made a full working Gwent set. You know, we talked about making a real one.
Yeah.
I'm going to put that into chat as well. I think it was a girl who's made it for a boyfriend for Christmas, I think it was.
Cool.
But it looks quite cool, quite impressive.
Effort.
The only problem with that is that it doesn't really work unless you know the people with working Gwent sets.
Well, it's a full... Sorry, it's not just a set, I think. It's a full working game.
But...
I
was going to say it would be a nice collector's thing to have, though, even if you can't play it that much, just to have it on you as a thing to look at every now and then. It'd be
five awesome. Laminated decks, a cotton canvas playing surface, tokens and gems in a wooden chest for their boyfriend. Yeah, that's quite cool. That's a nice Christmas present, that, I think.
It must have taken her a while to make as well. That's effort.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, what else have we got? Oh, there was one other thing I wanted to mention. Now, this has been around for a while, but the Batman, you know, the Batman Arkham Knight problems with the PC users have been having with frame rates and everything else, no FOV slider, etc. I just found out that all of the old Batman games, so Batman Arkham City, Arkham Asylum, Black, what was it?
Origins Blackgate, which is like a DLC for Origins, basically.
And Origins. I've got all of the Game of the Year editions in my Steam library now. They're given to me for free because I bought the game. And I've still got... Well, I didn't even buy it. I actually got Batman Arkham Knight for free with my graphics card. So I've got all of the Arkham games for free on my PC now, which is brilliant. Still not working, by the way. They're still patching it and doing things to it. I haven't played it yet, but apparently they still are patching it. So
what they're saying there is, if you go back to the beginning and play Arkham Asylum, Arkham City, Arkham Origins, and Arkham Origins Blackgate, by the time you finish playing them, we'll have fucking Arkham Knight patching them for it to work.
Trying to distract you for the next few months.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
I mean, to be fair, I've got them all anyway on my Xbox, but still cool. Still cool that I've now got them on PC too. We talked about that. Okay, so Prison Architect, my favourite game ever, that I talk about nearly every week, has now got female prisons. And there's slightly different things going on in female prisons. They released a dev update, and it's basically you now can have creches and special areas for female prisoners with babies, and female prisoners have different needs as well, so the hygiene needs are higher, for example, than male prisoners, and they've they've done a dev blog, and they've been very, very kind of careful with the way that they announced it, and it was quite funny, the blog, to be fair. But I hope they haven't got into trouble from it, from the female gaming community. But I think they've done a pretty good job of it. I had a quick go of it, and you know, I'm not particularly in the mood to play Prison Architects at the moment, but it's, you know, it is pretty cool. They've got female prisons. It's been one of them things. Apparently they didn't have a single female backer on the Kickstarter or their pre-orders, so they don't have any female, or they didn't have a single female that had, I think I got this impression anyway, that that gave them enough money for them to get a name in the game. So because they've got lots of male prisoners in the game where they've got a name and a backstory and all kinds of stuff that are based on the Kickstarter backers, so they gave them a story and put them in the game, but they didn't get a single female one, which is very interesting. I would have thought at least one, you know. Even though maybe they didn't, because they knew there would be male prisons early on.
Well, yeah, they wouldn't have mixed prisons, would they?
No. I guess. No. But yeah. Anyway. Okay, so the two big things. Let's get the one that Steve and Lou is not interested in out the way first off. The Konami news. Konami are hiring for a new Metal Gear without Kojima. This is old news now. It's like last week. But what do you think of that, Sam?
It's inevitable, wasn't it, really?
Yeah.
So, not surprising, just it's to be expected. Metal Gear Solid 5 was quite successful. I think it sold... I don't know where it's sitting in the charts, but it sold a fucking lot of units.
I think
units,
it sold
it?
10 or 20 copies, something like that.
Yeah, it sold. I got one and you got one, so that's two, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's doing all right.
And Steve was thinking about it, but he didn't actually bite the bullet, I don't think.
The point is that it's the first Metal Gear for a long time. The last main big title was a PlayStation 3 exclusive. So it was a full release on all different platforms, and it was got all these, like, you know, really high scores, and I think quite a few new people might have gotten into it that hadn't played the other ones,
yeah,
as well. So I think they might go, they might just basically take the assets they have from this game, the engine and all that kind of stuff, and make another game like that, like an open world sort of stealthy thing. They were going to do it. I just know they were going to do it. They own the rights to it. It's going to happen. It doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be a bad thing or it's going to be shit. It just isn't going to be. Had the same auteur sort of direction that the other games have. I mean, that might not be a bad thing in a way. It means something different. You get different outlooks. A good example of this is the new Star Wars film. I know it's not a game. Was done not by George Lucas at all, and it turned out, in my opinion, pretty goddamn good.
Have
and
we all seen? No. Okay.
It's good.
Have you seen it, Steve?
It's a Star Wars film, you know. That's an endorsement.
Yeah, I.
But if they can do that, if they could find somebody who works at Konami who goes, well, here's my love Metal Gear, here's my take on it, could be cool. I mean, it's just speculation at this stage.
Well, they're hiring, so they're going to be probably getting in a new director, someone who's a fan.
Do you both think that Kojima knew what it was that made Metal Gear Solid good?
Well, remember that Kojima is insanely influenced by Western culture as well.
Did you reckon he was a good helmsman for the series? Because George Lucas demonstrated that he didn't know what it was that made Star Wars good. That's why all the ones that he directed were shit.
He did direct the first one as well. That's pretty good.
He directed the first one. No, it's not. It's not as good as the second two.
Yeah. No, it's not as good, but it's still a good film.
The original trilogy, the first one, is definitely the weakest.
It is.
Yeah, well... Yeah, okay. But I think that...
Do you think that Kojima knew what it was that made Metal Gear Solid good? Do you think he had the right idea with the series?
I think the cult was what made Metal Gear, and then it's the same as the Final Fantasy VII kind of fandom. I don't think they were that popular in... You know, they might have sold a fair amount, but I don't think they were that kind of... Not that many people thoroughly enjoyed them. I don't know that many gamers that like Metal Gear games.
But it is touted as one of the best games. Like, you hear a lot of hype about it.
Four? I don't know how much influence he's had on that, because that's where all this I know he's had a lot, but I'm saying I don't know if he's been totally in control of 4. 4 is by far the best out of all of them in my eyes.
And you think 4's better than 5?
No, 5. Sorry, I meant 5. The new one, sorry.
The new one,
I always bloody forget that. I was speaking to someone the other day. They hate 4, and 4 was my favourite up until 5
4,
has come out.
4's very, like... I know these guys haven't seen it because we never did get around to doing a stream of it, but 4 is good. It's a great game. I love it, but I can understand why people wouldn't. Like, he really does try to say, well, I set up all these ridiculous loose ends. I'm just going to tie them all together, even if it doesn't really make that much sense. And you watch more than you play in that game. Yeah. If you don't skip any cutscenes, you spend more time watching than you do playing it, which is, to be fair, not something that any of the other Metal Gears had. Metal Gear 2, even though that's got a lot of shit in it, unless you're speedrunning it and you're really good, there's still a decent mix between playing and watching. Whereas in 4, you watch more than you play, I think.
The way that I played 3, in fact, the way that I played all of them, there was more cutscenes than there was gameplay. Because I was trying to run through them, wasn't I? I wasn't reloading it and saving it and stealthing through every single area. So there is less gameplay in the other ones as well. I even though there was massive cutscenes, 4 was more... I don't know, it felt better to me. The gameplay felt better. It felt more polished and more fun as a game, you know?
It's got good variety in it, 4 as well. People don't give it enough credit for.
Anyway, we're not talking about 4. But so, yeah, I mean, my opinion on the Kojima thing, I don't know. I really don't know. Because
it's hard to say, really, because a lot of the things that make Metal Gear Solid great, you can't necessarily say that they're attributed to him or not. I don't know how exactly he is in charge of mechanics, because there's been different mechanics in all of them. They've introduced new mechanics.
Hmm.
I don't know if he's just the story man, and the actual nuts and bolts gameplay stuff is not something that he is that involved in. So it's hard to say, really. I think it's his esoteric take on the alternate history and the lore and all that stuff that people are really into. I think that's sort of the big appeal of Metal Gear Solid.
I think what's
so in that sense, then yes, he does know what makes Metal Gear Solid good.
I think what's going to happen is that you're going to need someone to take the helm of this who has the guts to not necessarily try and provide fan service to people who like Kojima's stuff. Mm. You're going to get the situation where someone comes along and they don't have the guts to do that, to make it their own, or to push it in a certain direction, you're going to end up with what is going to kind of feel like a parody of the originals.
I agree, yes. And they shouldn't do that. They definitely shouldn't. If it's not Kojima, don't try and be Kojima.
Yeah. Yes, I agree with that. I think what they should do is try and, if they can, try and find another, you know, person, man or woman, who's like, I have a vision, and go, right, take your vision of Metal Gear and run with it in your own direction, so that it's now, instead of Hideo Kojima's Metal Gear, it's Da-da-da-da's Metal Gear Solid 6, and it's a new thing.
It's like having a new Bond actor every couple of films, you know. I'm not a big Bond fan, but every actor does it their own way, you know, or has their own take on it. I know it's
I think we're ripe for a reboot. I think what's going to happen is that whoever takes it over will take it in a different direction, and we'll probably have to take it from the beginning again.
I wouldn't mind that, because I think there's enough lore and there's enough story and detail in the world that they can do anything with it. And if a better director, someone who knows how to tell a story better, because I don't care what anybody says, I don't care what fanboys say, I don't enjoy the rambling 500 fucking word sentences that can be done in 2 words, you know. I would much rather just have a story that makes sense and a brilliant game that plays really well, and that's why I prefer 5 over the rest of them, because it's all optional. I have listened to all of the tapes. I have done every side mission and nearly every mission that counts anyway, and I've watched every cutscene and tried to get every single secret cutscene, but I didn't have to. The game was brilliant enough in itself, you know? And that's what I want. I want my Ethan Carters and my Dear Esters to do the storytelling, you know. I want Metal Gear to be a good stealth game, which it always has been, but it's always also overindulged, and I'm kinda happy. As a fanboy, I'm kinda happy he's not there, I think.
It's okay for him to step back. I think it's one of those things with games as well. a bit like with films or other things where you can go, well, I've had quite a lot of Hideo Kojima Metal Gear Solid games. So it's not like if someone else comes along and makes one and I'm not that bothered about it. Well, I've still got all the others. They still exist. They've not been erased. I still have them. I can still play them anytime I feel like it and enjoy them anytime I feel like it. So yeah, it's one of those things that people, it's just something that in our like, man-child culture that we have going on, where people really kick off about things when they go, Michael Bay is ruining the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. He's like, he hasn't. If you really love it that much, just fucking go and buy the DVDs of the cartoon and watch it. It still exists. He's not taking it away from you. He's not erased it from history.
Yeah.
That's the same applies to everything like that. They go, oh, he's ruined it. It's like, he hasn't ruined it. He made a new thing that you don't like. He hasn't ruined the old thing. It's not damaged it in any way. You should just still go and watch that and enjoy it.
I have to admit, I do feel that way about the Terminator movies after 2.
No. I disagree. I enjoy the new Terminator 4. Even 3, I don't mind it. It's awful in its own way, but it's also brilliant. It's also brilliant in other ways. I liked it as an action film. If I take away from the fact that Terminator 1 and Terminator 2 are the Alien and Aliens of the Terminator world, totally different types of films. I don't mind that 3 is shit, and to be fair, a lot of people don't like 4 as well, but 4 is a very different type of film to any of the others, but I still enjoyed it. 5 I thought was brilliant. I thought Genesis was wonderful, to be fair, but
I still haven't seen it yet.
No?
I don't have any plans to. I might watch it if it's like somebody else has got it.
I quite enjoyed the last one.
I thought Genesis was definitely more like the second film, more like Terminator 2 than any of the others, but still,
I mean, games are different in from films though, because if you endless sequels in movies to me are kind of a bad thing. Endless sequels in games can be good if they can make it worthwhile, because the technology evolves with the game and you can add different mechanics and you can blah 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 blah. It makes more sense for them to have Metal Gear Solid 6 now, or what's the new Final Fantasy going to be? 15? Is it 16? The next one?
Don't care.
If they can still, it doesn't. The point is they can still do that. Whereas if I say that like Die Hard 6 is coming out, it's like, mate, I'm not even fucking interested in that. I don't want to see it. I don't need any more grumpy old Bruce Willis pretending he's still John McClane when he's not. I just don't need that anymore.
I know what you mean. I'm the same. It's like totally nowhere near the same kind of not same level as like the Die Hards and the Terminators, but the Assassin's Creed games, got bored of them after a while, you know. Even though I liked them, I got bored of them. I got bored of them being the same thing, you know. And if it's the same with films, you know. Anyway, okay, so Kojima has moved on to a new studio. He's got his own new studio, which is surprisingly called Kojima Productions, which I didn't think he could take with him. I thought that would be economies as well.
Is it productions with a K? So it's like, it's not quite the same spelling.
It's got a different logo, but that's all I know. Anyway, his new game will be a timed PlayStation exclusive because he's done a deal with Sony, which we talked about briefly. But it'll be out on PC afterwards, which is nice of them to, even though we don't know what the game is yet, it's nice of them to at least say that.
I hope that he goes a bit down the horror route that he was doing with that Silent Hill PT thing that he did. I would like them, just because it'd be not Metal Gear, I'd be like, well, if you're going to do a new game, a new IP, go in and completely do new genre, do something entirely different. That's what I'd like to see him do, something different.
I probably wouldn't play it, but yeah, I'm happy for him. We'll do whatever he wants to do. If I like it, I like it. Simple as that.
Yeah.
He might be utterly fucking awful. It might not be up my street at all. I'm not a Kojima fanboy. You know, I was a Metal Gear fan. I liked the Metal Gear world and that. So, okay. So that's all the Konami Kojima news out the way for now.
Sorry, guys.
Finally, Final Fantasy VII Remake. We've got some news on that.
No, I couldn't actually spot any new news in here.
Yeah, me neither.
So I'm just saying the episodic rumour that we heard, it was only a rumour before, but it has now been confirmed, and he's now given us some quotes to say that it is going to be episodic and we're doing it because of this, because of that. He just I think he's had about five different interviews and said roughly the same thing each time. Basically just said, we're doing it because we're going to do something different with each one, that we wouldn't be able to fit it all into one release. It's still a load of bollocks. I don't fully understand it. I don't understand how they're going to do an open world with it. But we did discuss this at length, so...
Yeah. The quote here is quite nice. A proper HD remake of Final Fantasy VII that maintains the same feeling of density of the original results in a volume of content that couldn't possibly fit into one installment.
Installment or one release?
Except they did that in one installment in 1996.
Yeah. I don't get it.
I think the point is that they have that big a game with the amount of detail that they're showing. It just in terms of their graphical detail and stuff like that, I think it would just take up a lot of space.
No,
I don't really know.
The hard drive space is free. Bandwidth is free these days. It's not. That's a massive load of shit.
I personally think it's a little bit... I think what we... Well, we've already kind of discussed it, but I think it was Lou that would had said that there's a bit of... Or I don't remember who said it, but it was about them being... If we released episode one of Final Fantasy VII and it's shit, then we don't have to spend all the millions of... I thought it was
to do with marketing, to do more to do with that they can make more money out of doing it episodically, because if that, again, we don't know what they're going to charge for each episode.
Well, and they haven't released, as far as I'm aware, any of the other Final Fantasy main games episodically. They're just doing it with this one, so it seems like there's a little bit of a risk thing going on for them.
No, there's no risk.
Well, they seem to think there's something.
There's no risk. It doesn't matter. They could spend more than Destiny. Destiny's the most expensive game ever made, and they've still made money. It's a flop, but they've still made money. It's a flop for what they wanted to make, I think. But it doesn't matter what the budget is on this. It is going to sell. People aren't going to get bored of waiting, because we've already waited for, what was it, 97 or 98 it came out?
The best part of 20 years.
Yeah, nearly 20 years we've waited for the release, a re-release, and even if they redo it and change it, oh God, it's a load of shit. Have we lost you two? Are you...
Talking about something I've got really no opinion on, to be honest. Okay. I am listening.
I thought you liked Final Fantasy. I thought you were...
Oh, but the Final Fantasy thing. Yeah, well, the news that was on that that page, like Lou said, there's nothing really new there. It's all about, you know, they might do this, and someone said that this might happen. And
conjecture.
It's going to be episodic.
Yeah, they're releasing it in Unreal 4 as well. That's been confirmed. They're also said that 2016 is going to be a year of preparation. So they're not releasing it next year. Even though it's been in development for quite a while now. But, you know, I don't mind waiting for the right game. But what they're probably doing is getting everything and all the assets together.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I completely don't mind games being like delayed or put back or long, you know, kind of product life cycles for the right reasons.
Yeah.
You know, so a Duke Nukem Forever isn't one of them.
No, that was not one of them. But anyway, I think we're done. I think I ran over a little bit, but thank you for everybody who watched today. You guys got anything else you want to talk about, or any other news that's not been mentioned?
Nothing pressing. Just it looks like it could be a pretty good year for games, I think.
Yeah, I think there's going to be quite a few decent AAA games out, but I mean, I've been quite indie based this year. A lot of my interest has been around the indie market, because I don't follow every studio, because there's so many of them. I'm just kind of going off what looks good on Steam or what someone maybe recommends when it gets released, or I hear, you know, someone kick off in Twitter about things that's, you know, cool that's come out. So yeah, interested. Interesting. Right, so yes, on that note, let's just say goodbye, and everyone can say goodbye to Lou as well, if Lou's not going to come back after today. Thanks.
He'll be back.
Yeah, I won't. I'm sorry, I'm not having him back. I told you. He's not welcome. Anyway, yes, yeah, so we'll catch you all.
Feelings.
Yeah. We'll catch you all later, and have a good time.
Good whatever.
Have a good January, the first month of the year.
See you later, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.